Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order Monday, April the 4th, and certainly want to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. If we could just take a moment for silent meditation, please. Recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think it's very, very appropriate that tonight we have with us to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, a native of Durham, North Carolina, who went to the University of North Carolina, played basketball there, along with playing track, running track, and football and baseball. He was a four-sport person at the University of North Carolina and was a letterman in four sports. He is the only athlete in the history of the ACC to be a four-sport letterman. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you Albert Long.
Let me just say before the pledge that I want to congratulate these people right here, the Durham City Council, for having a moment of silent prayer and the pledge before your meetings. Because trust me, in my travels these past three, 4 years, I've seen a tremendous decline in that, a tremendous decline, especially in the school system and civic clubs. So my prayer is that it never happened here when one day two or three little people come up and fuss about God being in the Pledge of Allegiance. I hope these people take a stand and say it's going to stay where it is. So let's say, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Swan.
Ask the clerk if she would call the roll, please.
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden.
Present.
Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Johnson.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
Councilmember Reese.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Thank you very much. We have several proclamations tonight. And the first one is, let me find my script, the Week of the Young Child. Whereas early childhood from birth to age 5 represents the most critical time in children's development and is the foundation for success in school and life, according to the National Association for the Education of Young Children. And whereas Durham's Partnership for Children, Child Care Services Association, and other local collaborating organizations are celebrating the Week of the Young Child under the national theme of celebrating our youngest learners. And whereas making sure children are ready to learn is a community endeavor that involves parents, child care providers, policymakers, businesses, congregations, and community agencies. And whereas high quality early care supports Durham's current workforce for families with young children who rely on child care to work. And whereas early care and education is an economic development strategy at the beginning of the talent pipeline. And whereas early childhood programs support children and families as they prepare to enter school. And whereas transition to kindergarten must be a smooth, coordinated process for children, parents, and schools that greatly minimizes the achievement gap. Whereas comprehensive bilingual evidence programs in parent education and literacy increase family stability. And whereas early intervention, family support, and education can help break the cycle of poverty that affects more than half of Durham's children and create opportunities in early childhood that have a lasting impact in the community. And whereas the Durham City Council do hereby proudly recognize that the ages of birth to five are the most critical time in children's development, which builds the foundation for success in school and life. Now therefore, I, William V. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby proclaim April 10th through 16, 2016, as the Week of the Young Child in Durham, and hereby recognize Durham's Partnership for Children and Child Care Services Association for the exemplary model of collaboration, which continues to improve the landscape of early education for Durham residents and benefits present and future generations. Witness my hand in the corporate seal of the City of Durham this fourth day of April, 2016. And who is here? Oh, hey.
I'm right.
How you doing? Laura. Would you like, let me give you this.
Would. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having that time.
You're welcome.
Very welcome. Durham's partnership is your Smart Start agency, and Child Care Services Association is your child care resource and referral agency. On behalf of the staff and board of directors, thank you for this proclamation, and thank you for celebrating the Week of the Young Child. For 21 years, Durham's Partnership for Children has served as the convener and facilitator of our early childhood system. And Child Care Services Association has served in its role across Durham, as well as a 9-county region with national and state impact as well, for 42 years. As our city leadership, you serve far beyond these walls, as you well know, guiding our work and making a difference for young children. Our collaborations and mutual accountability run deep. We're grateful for you, Mayor Bell, a dedicated advocate for young children and a great reader in child care centers. Our own Paulette Stevens has been a leading voice in the education task force of Mayor Bell's Poverty Reduction Initiative. City Manager Bonfield, who continues to make young children a priority and is always ready with a listening ear and a helping hand. On our board, Rhonda Parker serves capably on behalf of our city. Amy Blaylock serves on our Community Awareness Committee. Toya Merritt sits on our Evaluation Committee. And I also had the great pleasure of serving on the Workforce Development Board under the esteemed leadership of Kevin Dick. Our state has long been a leader in its commitment to young children, and Durham's partnership has served as a real model, both in the state and nationally.
Pardon me, could you just hold for a minute? Could someone close the back door, please? Thank you. Go ahead.
When you educate young children, you build the cognitive and analytic skills that are represented in this room tonight. When you educate young children, you lay the foundation for success throughout life. You build civic engagement, and you build a strong community. So it's with great gratitude that we receive this proclamation tonight. And we, as a people and a community, are committed to educating our young children. Again, thank you so much for this recognition tonight.
Pardon me, Laura. Thank you. Let me say to all of you that have entered the chamber, we respect your right to protest. We would hope you respect our right to hold a meeting such as we're having. We don't have signs into the chamber audience. You're welcome to be here. but I would ask if you would hold your comments outside the Chamber of Commerce, outside the Chamber Room, if you don't mind. So if you can close the door, please. And if you can take your signs outside or put them down, you're welcome to stay at this public meeting where we have a process by how we hold public hearings. And I would hope that you would respect it, just as we respect your right to protest against whatever you're protesting against. So please respect the rights of persons who are going to be presenting proclamations here, and please respect the right of this council to conduct its business in an orderly fashion. Mayor Pro Tem, will you call the next person?
The next proclamation is Meatless Monday Month Proclamation. Wow, I should have read this earlier. Who is here for? Oh, come on up, please. And let me make sure I get the correct pronunciation of your name. Oh, okay, that's easy.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. Whereas 78.2% of Durham County residents do not eat the recommended 5 daily servings of fruits and vegetables, and 65% of adults in Durham County have a BMI, or body mass index, considered overweight or obese, obesity is associated with an increased risk of numerous health problems, including heart disease, type 2 diabetes, stroke, and several kinds of cancer. Whereas nearly 30% of North Carolina youth, 9th to 12th grades, are either overweight or obese, according to the 2013 Youth Risk Behavior Survey data, and 61% consume less than one serving of vegetables per day. Whereas obesity also affects the state's economy. In North Carolina, the medical costs associated with adult obesity were $17.6 billion in 2010. Whereas the American Dietetic Association recognizes that reduced meat consumption decreases the risk of various health problems, stating, and I quote, scientific data suggests positive relationships between a vegetarian diet and reduced risk for several chronic degenerative diseases and conditions, including obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and some types of cancer, unquote, and that vegetarians are less likely than meat eaters to be obese. Accordingly, experts recommend going vegetarian or at least increasing plant foods and eating fewer animal products to help weight control. And whereas the environmental impacts of abstaining from meat are significant, producing a single hamburger uses enough fossil fuel to drive a small car 20 miles and enough water for 17 showers. A recent United Nations report concluded that a global shift toward a vegan diet is necessary to combat the worst effects of climate change. And researchers at the University of Chicago concluded that switching from a standard American diet to a vegan diet is more effective in the fight against climate change than switching from a standard American car to a hybrid. Whereas a growing number of people are reducing their consumption of animal products in order to prevent animal cruelty. Approximately 1 billion animals would be spared if animal consumption was reduced by only 10%, a figure that would be achieved by a national Meatless Monday, whereas a weekly reminder to restart healthy habits encourages success and we are more likely to maintain behaviors begun on Monday throughout the week. And whereas the Triangle Meatless Mondays initiative offers free resources, including recipes to Durham County residents through its printed materials and online resources, and whereas many local restaurants are now offering meatless menu items to make it easier for citizens to reduce the amount of meat they eat, and whereas Durham also is proud to recognize many additional communities, organizations, and groups who participate in Meatless Mondays around the world. Now, therefore, I, William V. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby proclaim April 2016 as Meatless Monday month, starting today, in the City of Durham, and encourage and call upon the residents of Durham to observe this month in recognition of the value and benefits of reducing meat in the diet and to promote healthy, meat-free diets within the City of Durham. You may introduce yourself and you have a couple of
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
please.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mary Bell and council members, for welcoming us and proclaiming April as Meatless Monday month. Meatless Monday is part of an international campaign that encourages individuals, schools, hospitals, and other businesses to eat meat-free one day a week to improve their health, increase environmental sustainability, and reduce the number of animals suffering in factory farms, as well as introduce them to the benefits of adding more plant-based foods to their diets. Durham joins many other cities who have adopted similar resolutions and proclamations, such as Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Cleveland, and San Diego. Eleni Vlachos and Caitlin Grady and I are co-organizers of the Triangle Meatless Monday, a Durham-based organization run completely by volunteers. We began in 2011 with the help of Tobin Freed, the city's sustainability manager. So far, we have received pledges from over 2,500 local citizens to go meat-free at least one day a week. As the proclamation states, more than 78% of us in Durham do not eat the recommended servings of fruits and vegetables. This affects our health as well as the health of our environment. Meatless Monday is promoted by many health organizations, including the American Heart Association. Several common health problems, such as obesity, diabetes, hypertension, and some types of cancer, can be mitigated through eating less meat and animal products and adding more plant-based foods. Reducing meat consumption also has a positive impact on the environment by reducing the amount of water and energy used to produce food. April 22nd is Earth Day, so this is the perfect month to get started on meat reduction. To that end, we have also just begun our fourth Bull City Vegan Challenge. This is a popular month-long contest challenging top local chefs at Durham restaurants to add a plant-based dish to their menus. Customers try the dishes throughout April and then vote on the best. This year, 15 restaurants are competing. The idea is to support and promote local businesses, engage our community while making more room at the table for everyone, and showing how popular and in-demand plant-based options are. We have some items to share with you, including some samples and handbills about the challenge. We also have some informational brochures for you to look at as well. You can also learn more by going to trianglemm.com. And thank you so much for helping to further emphasize the power of meat-free meals. And we invite you to participate in Meatless Mondays with us, as well as the April Chef Challenge. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I would just ask my council members to eat quietly while I proceed with the emergency. Our next proclamation is National Public Safety 911 Communications Officer Week. National Public Safety 911 Communications Officer Week is observed across the nation the week of April 10th through the 16th. In honor of the occasion, the Durham City Council issues the following proclamation. Whereas when an emergency occurs, the prompt response of police, fire, and EMS is critical to the protection of life and preservation of property. And whereas communication officers are the first and most critical contact our citizens have with emergency services. And whereas each 911 communication officer has exhibited compassion, understanding, and professionalism during the performance of their job in the past year. National Public Safety 911 Communications Officer Week in Durham is proclaimed by William B. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, and urge all citizens to take special note of this observance in honor of the men and women whose diligence and professionalism keep our city and citizens safe. Here to receive this proclamation from the Durham Emergency Communications Center is their recently announced Employee of the Year. This individual has demonstrated over the past 12 months exceptional customer service to the citizens of Durham and the extraordinary ability to operate the police channels and serve in an acting supervisor position. She has been nominated several times by her coworkers for a 7-star award for her efforts and consistently creates and projects a positive attitude and makes the workplace environment more rewarding. It is my honor to present this proclamation to the Durham Emergency Communications Employee of the Year, Ms. Jamie Helms.
Hi, Jamie. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. I accept this proclamation with great honor. I've always prided myself on being a great employee. I've been with the city a little over 8 years, and I've grown professionally and as an individual. It's been wonderful being a part of the City of Durham and in the 911 Center. And again, I say thank you.
The next proclamation is fair housing.
Oh, okay.
Did everybody get fed? Okay, all right. Okay. Whereas April marks the anniversary of the passage of the Fair Housing Act of 1968, which sought to eliminate discrimination in housing opportunities and to affirmatively further housing choices for all Americans. And whereas the ongoing struggle for dignity and housing opportunity continues to be an issue, and vigorous local efforts must continue to combat discrimination. And whereas the Durham City Council has authorized the Human Relations Division of the Neighborhood Improvement Services Department to take necessary action to enforce the city's Fair Housing Ordinance and the Federal Fair Housing Act of 1968, as amended, and whereas ongoing fair housing education, outreach, and monitoring is the key to raising awareness of a person's fair housing rights and responsibilities, and whereas only through commitment, continued cooperation, and full support from the Durham community can the barriers to fair housing be removed. Now, therefore, I, William V. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, do hereby proclaim April 2016 as Fair Housing Month in Durham, and hereby urge all citizens to take special note of this observance by promoting good, fair housing practices throughout the City of Durham. And here to accept this proclamation is Delilah Dunnison, and who else?
Phil Seid.
Okay, oh, Chair. Phil. Yeah. The Chair of the Human Relations Commission. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem, and thank you, Mayor and City Council, for this. This is the 48th year to celebrate the Fair Housing Act, and we are so pleased that the City of Durham has allowed us, the Human Relations Division, to be a part of the city and enforce the City of Durham's City of Durham's Fair Housing Ordinance. I would like to announce that we have five events that will take place during this month. And starting on Saturday, April the 9th, there will be the second annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Good Neighbor Breakfast. And this will be held at the First Presbyterian Church. It will start at 11 o'clock and go from 11 o'clock to 12:30, and there will be awards given out there. And Warren Herndon is the contact person for this event. We also are having a training for fair housing for persons with disabilities and reasonable accommodations. This will take place on Thursday, April 14th, from 10 o'clock until 12 o'clock. This will take place in the NIS third floor conference room, and all of these events are also listed on the website. The next event is the Housing Discrimination on Families with Children. And this particular event will take place in Spanish. It's a bilingual presentation that will be given. And this will take place on Friday, April the 22nd, also the third floor NIS department conference room. And this is from 2 o'clock until 4 o'clock p.m. The next event is Race Relations Then and Now, Journey to Justice. We will have a speaker, Douglas Jones. It will take place in this same room here. This will be Thursday, April the 28th, from 3 o'clock until 4:30. And this presentation will be given, as we said, by Douglas Jones. And when Chair Phil Seib comes up, he'll talk a little bit about Douglas Jones. And the last event, the Human Relations Commission Award Ceremony, the Chair of the Human Relations Commission, Phil Seib, is here, and he's gonna talk about that. Phil?
First, I'd like to thank the City Council, the Mayor, and the City Manager for taking fair housing so seriously in the City of Durham. There are a couple of points I wanted to bring up. The first point was the Human Relations Commission's Award Ceremony. It will happen on April 28th. That's where we award four people who have done excellent service for the city in regards of creating great human relations. The second part is that I would like to thank Delilah. This will be Delilah's last proclamation before she retires. And I would like to thank her for her service. I've worked with her, I've had the pleasure of working with her for 4 years. She is an excellent, outstanding person and a good role model for a strong, a strong, smart, independent woman. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Okay.
Thank you for your work.
Yeah. And now, where's Wayne? Oh, hi.
Boy, I must be losing my vision.
Are you going to stand here with me or?
Come on, don't be afraid. Don't be bad.
We're encouraging our citizens to conserve water. And this is the Weilen Foundation National Mayor's Challenge for Water Conservation Proclamation. Whereas the City of Durham continues to explore ways to manage residential consumption of water and to inspire its citizens to preserve and protect our national resources, especially our water supplies. And whereas the City of Durham, as an EPA Water Sense partner, encourages our community to conserve water and be water efficient whenever possible. And whereas the Wyland Foundation has sponsored the National Mayor's Challenge for Water Conservation for 5 years, promoting active competition among cities of all sizes across the nation to reduce water use by the adoption of water efficient behaviors and practices. And whereas from April 1st through 30th of 2016, the city wishes to inspire its customers and its neighboring communities to participate in the challenge by making a series of online pledges to reduce their impact on the environment by decreasing water use and striving to be more efficient for the period of 1 year. 1 year. Now, therefore, I, William V. Bilbell, mayor of the greatest city on earth, Durham, North Carolina, you may applaud, do hereby proclaim that the city is an active participant in the Wyland Foundation National Mayor's Challenge for Water Conservation and encourage Durham citizens to take the conservation challenge between April 1st, 2016 and April 30, 2016 by making an online pledge at www.mywaterpledge.com. Witness my hand in the corporate seal of the city of Durham. This is the fourth day of April. And James? You may make place. Are you going to throw something in?
Well, I have to speak on behalf of Wayne.
Okay, then.
So, on behalf of Wayne and the rest of the Department of Water Management, thank you, Mayor Pro Tem, Mayor, City Council, for supporting the challenge again this year. Last year, mayors in 39 states challenged their residents to make over 390,000 pledges to promote drought resiliency, protect our watersheds, and ultimately reduce our stress on our water resources and our aging infrastructure. Here in Durham, we know that our citizens are very conscientious about water and environmental issues and are always ready to do their part to save this precious resource. And for that, we are very grateful and very proud. In terms of the challenge this year, not only is it the right thing to do, but it's also a great opportunity for individuals and the city to win some great prizes. This year, again, they'll be giving away a Toyota Prius, gift cards, other eco-friendly prizes, and the city has the opportunity to win a landscape makeover for a pocket park, which will feature a highly efficient state-of-the-art irrigation system. So we're hoping our citizens and everybody here will help us make that possible by making their pledge at mywaterpledge.com. We have until April 30th to do that. So I encourage everybody to, again, visit mywaterpledge.com and also visit durhamsaveswater.org and follow Durham Water on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you again.
Can we do a photo?
Yeah. Who's taking the picture?
Who has the camera?
I do.
Okay, you do the camera. And Wayne dropped it first. My colleagues. Wayne dropped both back. Position. Okay. Hurry here. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mayor. Pro Tem. Let me ask, are there announcements by members of the council?
Yes, Mr. Mayor.
Recognize Councilman Reese.
Wanted to express my thanks and the thanks of the people of Durham to the make sure I get this right, the Select Committee on Strategic Transportation Planning and Long-Term Funding Solutions of the North Carolina General Assembly. Today, that a select committee of the House met in Raleigh and by unanimous bipartisan vote approved a measure that would, if taken up by the rest of the General Assembly, remove the funding cap that the General Assembly placed on light rail projects during the last budgetary cycle. And while we will and do have significant disagreements with members of the General Assembly and their leadership on other issues, I want to thank Chairman John Torbett and the rest of the members of the Select Committee for standing up for the principle that data-driven decisions about transportation make the best public policy. So look forward to seeing the cap raised and a light rail becoming a reality here in Durham.
Councilman Reese, and I appreciate that. Hope it gets back to the General Assembly. Are there other members with announcements? I got an announcement. The game started a half an hour ago. So I know this is April Fool's belated. I don't know if anybody wanted to leave. That's
don't play with me, Mr.
Okay,
Mayor.
All right.
Don't
all right.
Play with me.
Oh, that didn't work. Okay, let's go on with the dinner.
Mr. Mayor, everybody knows that both you and I are Duke fans. We really don't care that much, do we? We can go all night.
Uh-oh. All right. We'll move with the announcements. First priority by the city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everyone. Agenda item number 28 is a supplemental item public hearing on the proposed economic development incentive agreement in the city of Durham in Aurobindo Pharma, USA.
City manager's priority items. It's been brought to move and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Likewise, city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
Likewise, city clerk.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. GBA item number 3, Citizens Advisory Committee appointment. You did have additional information submitted by Mr. Tavion Powell for your consideration.
Entertain a motion on the city clerk's priority item. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. The agenda is as follows. We have a consent agenda. Consent agenda items may be approved with a single vote. If a member of the council or a member of the audience asks to have a consent agenda item removed, we'll discuss that later in the agenda, and I'll just read each consent agenda heading. Item 1 is approval of City Council minutes. Item 2 is the Durham Performing Arts Center Oversight Committee. Item 3 is an item that can be found on the general business agenda. Item 4 is FY 2016-2017 budget development guidelines, and I'm going to pull that. We have persons that want to speak on that item. That's item 4. Item 6 is professional services, engineering services for Southeast Regional Lift Station contract award to Hazen and Sawyer PC. Item 7 is February 2016 bid report. Item 8 is the bid purchase of 12 light transit vehicles. Item 9 is resolution approving an installment financing contract and deed of trust and authorization to execute associated legal documents. Item 10 is design services for the Campus Hills pool dehumidification improvements. Item 11 is network hub license agreement between the City of Durham and Google Fiber, North Carolina, Inc., North Carolina LLC. Item 12 is employee fitness tracking dashboard and fitness trackers. Item 14 is intergovernmental agreement with the U.S. Geological Survey for Lower Ellapee Creek groundwater surface water interaction study. Item 15 is Eno River Watershed Improvement Plan. Item 16 is revision to City Code Section 70-50- service area fees for waterline projects. Item 17 is an item that can be found on the general business agenda. Items 18 through 24 are items that can be found on the general business agenda with that's it. So entertain a motion for approval of consent agenda items with the exception of consent agenda item 4.
So moved.
Second. Sure. Which item is item 4 is what was pulled on the budget.
K Councilmember Johnson, will you turn your mic on, please? Thanks.
I'm sorry. Folks had told me that they were interested in speaking on the item regarding the installment finance contract.
That's item nine. No one pulled it.
No one pulled it. Okay, great. Thank you.
Can I vote now? Can you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll move to the general business agenda. Item three is Citizens Advisory Committee appointment. You have a question?
I have a question.
We only had one applicant.
Exactly, Mr. Tavion Powell.
Mr. Mayor, I had...
Let's see. Had you finished your question?
I see that he did not have any experience, but I don't think you necessarily need any. As long as you can look at information and decipher it and be fair, I have no problems with it. I didn't hear the discussion on it before. That's just my two cents.
That's Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I had asked that this be put on GBA because Mr. Powell had not previously submitted any information about himself, but thanks to the city clerk's office, he now has, and I'm fine with supporting it. Thank you.
It's been properly moved and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll move to item four. Item 17, MoogFest funding and economic impact.
Mr. Mayor, as you recall at the work session, Council heard a request and presentation from representatives of the MoogFest organization regarding a funding request associated with their festival, which will occur May 19th through 22nd. The Council heard that report, and I believe because the Mayor Pro Tem was unavailable at afternoon, asked that this matter be placed on the consent or the GBA for further discussion this evening. Certainly be glad to answer any questions.
I recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you. I'm sorry I could not be here for the discussion. I have one concern, and that is that we be fair to the Art of Cool as well, who has presented a request for $20,000, which is a very meager amount. And I would like to know at some point soon what the disposition of that $20,000 request is. I tend to look at things through as a member of the Board of Directors of the National League of Cities. We have a program that looks at racial equity. And so that's how I'm viewing this, through a racial equity lens. I would like to make sure that if we're going to give MoogFest what they've requested, that we do the same with the Art of Cool. It's a racial issue.
If I could, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, the representatives from the Art of Cool provided some information after the meeting that Thursday. We had not seen any of that beforehand. The Office of Economic Workforce Development is currently reviewing that information, and I'm confident that we'll have a recommendation to come back to the Council within the next cycle or two prior to the Art of Cool event occurring.
Yeah, and I think we need to look at this thing holistically in the future, because as you know, we at one time, one of the biggest black festivals in Durham, Bembe, was moved from downtown out to the one of the parks, and it gives an appearance that certain things are not supposed to be downtown. And I want us to make sure that race is not an issue when we're making decisions to hold events downtown. I guess many people don't understand what I'm saying when I say racial equity. Art of Cool is led by a black woman, and MoogFest is a Caucasian woman. So they need equal, is that correct? They need equal consideration. Thank you.
Further comments on this item? If not, entertain a motion on the item. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We're on a general business agenda for public hearings. Item 18 is zoning map change, Rose Walk Club Boulevard.
Good evening. My name is Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I can confirm, affirm that all legal notices required, all notice requirements have been executed in accordance with state and local law for public hearing items 18 through 24, and affidavits for such are on file in the Planning Department. Zoning case Z15-00020. Rosewalk Club Boulevard is a request to change the zoning designation of 5.59 acres located on West Club Boulevard between North Duke Street and Ruffin Street from residential urban 5RU5 and residential urban RU52 to plan development residential 10.8 for our future residential development. The development plan associated with this request commits to the following: 60 maximum residential units, one access point, and 3% tree coverage. The text commitments on the development plan include closing the existing right-of-way for Sally and Hildreth Street, a mix of housing types, a community green space, and a buffer along the northern property. Graphically, the development plan commits to general locations of one site access point, location of tree preservation areas, and a building and parking envelope and project boundary buffers in excess of ordinance standards. Staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances. Planning Commission did recommend approval on November 10th, 2015 by a vote of 11-0, and I am available for any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. This is a staff report. This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. You've heard the staff report. I would ask first, are there questions by members of the council on the staff report? If not, we have one person that is signed to speak on this item, Robert Chapman. Let me ask, is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item, this being a public hearing? If not, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. I am a new urbanist developer. I have done projects in North Carolina, Florida, and Arkansas, including three projects in this area, Trinity Heights behind Duke East Campus, redevelopment of the West Gear Foster Street area, and a project in Chapel Hill named Winmore. And in each case, we've tried to create a place that is walkable and has the highest level of quality construction and quality detail. We're very excited that for this project, we have Lou Oliver, who we consider to be one of the great planners and designers in the country, as our planner. And we think that we're going to create a place that is almost becomes a tourist attraction because it sets a new level of unfolding delight while you're there. One of the things that we did in the project in in Chapel Hill at Winmore is that we voluntarily offered to provide 61 low-income housing tax credit units within a relatively high-income community, and those were built in addition to about 40 small units, so almost half of the units were considered affordable under Carborough's ordinance. We're hoping this time, within a relationship with the Durham Community Land Trust, to have at least 10 units that are considered affordable by Durham standards, and we have signed a letter of intent with the Durham Community Land Trustees, Selena Mack. They're going to help us accomplish that. again, that's a voluntary offer and challenge that we've challenged ourselves to accomplish, and we're pretty confident that we'll be able to do that. One of the council people asked me a couple of questions, and I promised to get back and answer them, and I haven't yet, so I'll answer them right now. On the plan, it says that it's 100% impervious, and I spoke to Dan Jewell, and he said that that's the maximum allowed by the ordinance and that we don't know what the impervious is going to be, but we anticipate it's probably going to be 50%, no more than 70%. I also received a question about mass grading. It's a relatively small site, only 5.59 acres, with a fairly deep gully down the middle of it, so there's going to be a substantial amount of grading. But we're going to try to save all of the specimen trees that we possibly can. We've approached the Ellerby Creek Watershed Association and met with Steve Kahn and Chris Dreps and asked them to make this project a pilot project for best practices, which they have offered to do, and we're looking forward to that. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Let me ask other questions by members of the council of the developer. Plans. Again, this is a public hearing. Is there anyone else in the public that would like to speak on this item?
I would like to speak in support of this item.
Could you come to the microphone, please, and state your name and address?
Good evening, members of City Council. My name is Selena Mack. I'm the Executive Director of Durham Community Land Trustees, and I'm just here tonight in support of this project. As Bob mentioned, the two of us have signed a letter of intent to include at least 10 units of affordable housing in this project. So we're really excited about being able to work with this caliber of developer and with the prospect of this being a model for affordable housing being incorporated into for-profit development in the future. So we really would appreciate your support, and thank you very much. I'm sorry, what? My address, I'm sorry, 1208 West Chapel Hill Street, Durham, 27701. Thank you.
Anyone else that wants to speak on this item? If not, the matter's back before the council. I didn't close the public hearing. I'm back before the council for any comments. I saw Councilman Moffitt raise his hand.
I do. Since you've raised the issue of affordable housing, which I applaud, the zoning includes only what's committed, and we're having a zoning discussion tonight. So can you talk to us about what you'd be willing, let me say it a different way. So I'm a little concerned, we're talking about affordable housing units without any kind of surety, any kind of assurance, as might be happening with a proffered commitment.
No, this is not a proffered commitment. This is, we're challenging ourselves. We're doing this totally voluntarily. In our letter of intent with the Durham Community Land Trust, they are going to come back to you if we do apartments, rental apartments, and ask for a change in your ordinance so that the maximum income level would be increased to 80% of the AMI. So there are a lot of pieces that have to be put into place, but I've done large affordable projects before and had some success, and I'm taking this as a personal challenge, not as something that anyone's making us do.
Well, I appreciate that, Mr. Chapman, but I will, as I always say to anybody that's in here for rezoning, I'm only concerned with the application itself and the commitments that are proffered.
But we wanted people to know in advance that we were intending to do this.
And I wish you the best for that.
Thank you. Any further comments, questions by members of the council? Just a minute. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Mr. Mayor, just quickly, thank you. I support this development. But I did want to mention one thing, because this is the mass grading was mentioned, and I know it will be coming up later as well in another case that we're looking at tonight. And I just want to ask us, Mr. Mayor, to begin thinking about our tree removal ordinances and our mass grading ordinances. And I just want to put in front of my colleagues we've heard a lot of talk at our coffees with council about the tree canopy, and I think that our I think we need to be looking at our tree grading ordinance or our mass grading ordinance. So, Mr. Manager, I just want to urge you all, if the administration would consider bringing back to us an ordinance that might be looking at some of the other model ordinances around the state and the country and seeing what we can do. I know it's an interest of yours, and so I just wanted to see, just briefly put that on our agenda. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Well, that's a good point, because I can tell you there's a development over near my neighborhood on 54 that this council approved, and they've done mass grading, and I've gotten feedback from neighborhoods further away from there in terms of how the pond has gotten polluted because of this runoff. And I know we always say that people downstream can't hold people responsible upstream for what they do, but we really need to try to find some kind of way to manage that and monitor a lot better than is occurring now. So I fully support that. If there are no further questions, I'm going to close the public hearing. Now the matter is back before the council. Entertain a motion on an item. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? I close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you very much.
Item 20 is a zoning map change, Hope Valley Commons Business Park, Z15-000023.
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor, you all need to get the consistency statement for the last item.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
Passes 7-0.
Move to item 19, comprehensive plan amendment, Hope Valley Commons Business Park, A150010.
Good evening. I'm Laura Woods with the Planning Department, and this plan amendment is associated with zoning map change case Z150023. The presentation on that case will follow this one. The applicant in this case, Horvath Associates PA, requests an amendment to the future land use map from office to commercial for a 4.5-acre site located in the vicinity of the intersection of North Carolina Highway 54 and North Carolina 751. It is adjacent to an existing shopping center. The site is in the suburban tier and is within the Falls Lake, Jordan Lake B watershed protection overlay. The site is currently vacant. According to the applicant, the purpose of the amendment from office to commercial is to support a rezoning to allow a mini storage facility. Staff recommends approval based on conditions warranting an amendment to the future land use map and the proposed land use pattern meeting the four criteria for plan amendments. Planning Commission recommended approval of this case 11-2 on February 9th, 2016, based on information provided in the staff report, the applicant's justification, information heard at the public hearing, and meeting the criteria for plan amendments. That concludes my report. Staff will be available to answer your questions.
Thank you again. This is a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. I would ask for their questions first by members of the council. If not, this is a public hearing. We have two persons that have signed up to speak. Well, actually four persons. And we'll hear from the proponents first and allow 10 minutes, and then we'll hear from the opponent. Our proponents are Tim Sivers and did you sign up? Well, we just have two people. You signed up twice.
Tim Sivers, Horvath Associates, 16 Consultant Place, Durham, North Carolina. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council, for the time to speak tonight. I'd like to thank the staff for the reviews. As Laura mentioned, this is a 4.5-acre site located near the NC 54-751 intersection. It is a wooded site. In 2003 and 2005, the site was a development plan came through the council which was approved, but nothing was ever constructed on the site. At this point, we're coming back through with a CG zoning to allow self-storage. The proposed commercial land use for this area will expand the existing land use. It'll also provide proposed land use is also consistent with the adjacent land use in the area. We believe that that this use will fit, and I'm available for any questions. Thank you.
Are there questions of the developer? If not, recognize Chris Saunders.
Hello. Thank you for the opportunity to voice my concerns about this project. This proposal has raised a broader question about overbuilding in the South Durham area of self-storage facilities. Oh, sorry, Chris Sanders, 204 Sedgemoor Drive, Cary, North Carolina. My parents actually live in the Hope Valley development. Let's see, there are currently 13 self-storage facilities in South Durham. In the last 2 months, we've already seen a large ample storage facility open on Martin Luther King Jr. Parkway, 2 miles north of South Point Mall, as well as another ample storage rezoning which was approved at 5515 Highway 55, just south of the Highway 54 and Highway 55 intersection. There will also be a large expansion, at least 100,000 square feet or more, at Ample Storage's Garrett Road location, 2.5 miles from this proposed site at Hope Valley Commons. Let's see, there is a tremendous amount of storage space coming onto the market in a very short period of time. The current proposal of up to 400,000 square feet is of an unprecedented size. Thousands of units will be added to the market, and South Durham will be completely oversaturated. Competition is a good thing, but on this scale, we feel it's more conducive to creating a monopoly as opposed to a competitive environment. I would also question whether commingling moving trucks entering and exiting the shopping center to access the proposed facility would also take away from a shopper-friendly experience or environment. So in conclusion, I would ask that you carefully consider the rapid expansion that's already taking place and in this area of South Durham, and if this is truly in Durham's best interest. And I just thank you all very much for your time.
Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item in the public? If not, the matter's back before the council, and the council may ask questions of the developers or those in opposition. I'm going to recognize Councilman Moffitt and Councilman Davis in that order.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I actually have a question for staff. We've heard about the proposed use. Can you briefly tell us what the allowed use, if this, in the commercial, you know what? I always want to get the rezoning first. I'm going to hold my question until we get to the rezoning. Thanks.
Recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to ask Mr. Saunders about, he said, on one hand, you said the oversaturation of storage units, and then you said there will be a monopoly. So can you tell me how the monopoly would occur?
Particularly Ample Storage has been granted several rezonings recently, whether it be Garrett Road, Highway 55, also. Correct. That's what I meant. Okay.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
This is one of those times when doing a plan amendment prior to the rezoning, to me, gets the cart before the horse, because only if we were going to approve the rezoning should we really consider the plan amendment, although Let me withdraw that comment. Let me just say this. I think that office industrial that is the appropriate buffer for the adjoining properties. I can't really see why we would change that to commercial, and so I'll be voting against it.
Recognize Councilman Reese.
I just wanted to voice my support for the perspective that Councilman Moffitt just raised. I think when we get to the zoning question, I'll have a lot more to say about the permissible uses under the zoning that's been proposed by the applicant. But for at this time, I agree that the current use in the map is appropriate.
Are there other questions, comments on this item? If not, is there anyone else in the public who wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect no one else has to speak. I will declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is back before the council. Entertain a motion on the item. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
The motion fails with Mayor Bell voting no, Councilmember Johnson voting no, Councilmember Moffitt voting no, Councilmember Reese voting no. Okay, all right.
Thank you. We'll move to the next item. Item 20, zoning map change, I'm sorry. Item 20, zoning map change, Hope Valley Commons Business Park, Z1500023.
Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. Zoning case Z1500023, Hope Valley Commons Business Park, is a request to change the zoning designation of 4.536 acres located at 7101 and a portion of 7103 West North Carolina 751 Highway from office institutional with the development plan and commercial center with development plan to commercial general with a development plan for a proposed use of self-storage. However, this is not committed to on the development plan. The development plan associated with this request commits to the following: a maximum of 400,000 square feet of building footprint, one access point, a 70% maximum impervious surface, 10% tree coverage. The developer does not proffer any text commitments at this time. Graphically, the development plan commits to general location of one side access point, location of tree preservation areas, and building and parking envelopes and project boundary buffers. Staff determines that based on the motion that you guys made, this request is not consistent with the comprehensive plan and adopted policies. Planning Commission did recommend approval on February 9th, 2016 by a vote of 11-2. I'm available for any questions you may have. Thank you.
Again, it's a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. Entertain comments from members of the council. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, I'll ask my question now. We've heard about proposed use. Can you tell us about allowed uses if this rezoning were to be approved?
If this zoning were to be approved, any use that's allowed in the CG district would be allowed on this site.
Can you give us a few examples?
It's most commercial uses that are allowed by the ordinances.
Okay. Fast food restaurant?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Other questions, comments? You have a question?
No, I don't.
Okay. I'm getting ready to call Mr. Sivers, and I have Chris Saunders. Mr. Sivers.
Yes, thank you, sir. Councilman Moffitt.
5 minutes.
Okay, thank you, sir. Councilman Moffitt, I'd just like to respond to your question. What Kyle said is correct. However, this development plan does not have a traffic study involved with it. Therefore, it limits the site to 150 peak hour trips. So a restaurant would not meet that requirements. There's too many trips at a restaurant, so you would not even be able to develop a 3,000 square foot restaurant on this site. So self-storage with the peak hour trip, so you're limiting yourself to the number of trips, which is a very low end use. But I would like to follow up with the voting of the plan amendment, I would like to ask for a 60-day deferral, if the council is willing to grant that.
We'll decide that later. Do you have any more comments on that?
No, thank you. I'm just available for questions.
All right, thank you. We have Chris Saunders to decide to speak on this item also.
When I was signing up, that was really what I meant to speak on, both of those items. But yet the CGD with the development plan, of course, that allows the self-storage as well. But that's all I had to say.
Are there other persons that want to speak on this item being a public hearing item? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing and bring the item back to the council. Recognize first Councilwoman Johnson, then Councilwoman Moffitt in that order.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I had a question for Mr. Sivers. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Let me do this. I'm going to keep the public hearing open as, okay, as a part of the comments.
So okay, thank you.
Great. So I just wanted to ask, why isn't self-storage a committed plan? It seemed, you know, the intention to build self-storage, I think that we would feel more comfortable approving it if we knew that it was going to be self-storage as opposed to any of the other allowed commercial uses. And so is there a reason that you all chose not to commit to a self-storage in your development plan?
The original reason was because of the limiting trip factor, but I have no problem committing to self-storage as a use.
That's Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, thank you. I appreciate, I understand the question about continuing the case for 60 days. Can you tell me what you hope to accomplish if we continue for 60 days and hear it again?
Well, I'd like to meet with some of the council members and discuss these items further. I'd like to also meet with Mr. Saunders and discuss some of his concerns. One of his concerns he did bring up was that the traffic will be coming through the shopping center. The entrance is actually off of 751, and that entrance is actually on this parcel. This parcel is not landlocked, even though it's set back to the back of 751. The property touches 751 by the use of the existing entrance that's there. So the main traffic will be using the entrance that's already located on this site. So I would just wanted to go over that with Mr. Saunders and clarify that and just discuss any other comments. That's it, sir.
Are there other questions? Recognized Councilman Shule. Comments?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to say that I appreciate my colleagues' concern about the commitment, and I think that if you all would be willing to commit to that, that would be great. I actually think this is a good place for self-storage. I think, you know, whether or not the market demand is there for all of this self-storage, I'm not able to judge, but I do think that if that commitment was there, that that would give everyone a lot of comfort. And I understand, Mr. Saunders, your concerns. You know, these are competitive concerns, these are competitive business concerns, and while I recognize them as important to you and valid, I don't think that's what we're here to make a judgment about. You know, if you were willing to proffer that, I would be certainly willing to support it. So.
Yes, I'm definitely willing to proffer that self-storage would be a use.
Recognize our planning director, Steve Mittman.
Point of clarification, sure. Mr. Sivers, are you saying it will be the only use or a use?
Not necessarily the only use, in case we do want to have some retail shops potentially. We would still need to stay under this 150 peak hour trips, but I am willing to state that it's the primary use.
Are there other questions, comments on this item before I close the public hearing?
Sorry, may I speak again?
Sure.
My client just said we is willing to proffer that it is the only use. Self-storage will be the only use.
Okay. You have comments?
No, at the appropriate time, I'm happy to move that we continue it for four cycles so that they can have the meetings they want to have.
Are there further questions, comments? I guess we continue the public hearing until four cycles rather than closing the public hearing. Is that your intent of your motion, Councilman?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Recognize the city manager.
Get too far into this, but we're talking about reconsidering the previous motion on the plan amendment.
If I can, since council took the prior action on the plan amendment, it is typically consistent to apply the zoning consistent with the plan amendment under law. So staff would recommend that you reconsider your prior action if you are so inclined to approve a rezoning on this property.
Or consider it further.
Or consider it, yes, I'm sorry.
Recognize Councilman Shule.
And could that be done at the future date as well? Could that be done four cycles away if we held this for four cycles?
Needs to be re-advertised.
Yeah, you'll have to re-advertise and everything you'll
yeah,
want
we'll
to.
Yeah, we'll have to.
You'll want to do that. I mean, reconsidering it now.
Right. Could do it now.
Could reconsider it now.
Yeah.
Right.
We can't reconsider it.
Mm-hmm. You could reconsider and continue it.
And
yes.
Continue it.
All right. So, what's the motion?
Mr. Mayor, I'm wisely going to withdraw my motion, let somebody else try.
Mr. Mayor, if I could jump in there, because there's a legal procedure, and I haven't brought my legal procedures with me since I think 2007 or
You're
2008.
You're a walking legal procedure.
But I'm going to give it a shot here. So if you're going to reconsider, the motion and the second action needs to come from the winning side. So one of the four will have to make the motion, and one of the four will have to second the motion to reconsider, and that puts you back to the beginning of item number 19.
So I move that we reconsider our action on item 19, comprehensive plan amendment for Hope Valley Commons Business Park.
Is there a second to that?
I'm not going to second it. I will point out that we do have a precedent for considering a rezoning after denying a plan application. It was one of the first cases that I was involved with after I joined the council. It was a case that was heard originally by the council before I joined it. And in that meeting, the plan amendment was denied. The rezoning was not open for consideration, and it was held, we heard it at a later date. So I'm happy to leave it like that. I'm not making a second tonight.
Okay, I'm going to rule that the motion dies for lack of a second. We're back to the original in terms of trying to hold a public hearing open for four cycles. Is that your motion? Is there a second to that? Is there a second to that?
Second.
Oh, okay. All right, it's been properly moved to second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
I move to the next item, which is item 21, zoning map change, West Point 751, revision 3.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. Zoning case Z1500027, West Point at 751, revisions 3 is a modification of existing development plan and request to change the zoning designation of 17.36 acres located on southwest quadrant of intersection of NC 751 Highway and intersection 40 opposite Renaissance Parkway from commercial center with a development plan to commercial center with a development plan to allow for office and residential uses on PIN 0718-03-13-5216, also known as Building Envelope B. This development plan associated with this request keeps all commitments as previously approved with zoning cases Z08-00031 and Z12-00011. With the exception of text commitment number 6, has been reworded to only indicate the building graphic in building envelope A, and a new commitment has been added to address the building graphic in building envelope B. These are both associated with uses for those two buildings indicated on this plan. Staff does determine this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances, and Planning Commission recommended approval on February 9th, 2016 by a vote of 13-0. Thank you very much. I'm available for any questions.
Again, this is a public hearing. The public hearing is open to ask the questions by members of the council and staff. Hearing none, we have two people that have signed up to speak on this item. Both are proponents. Is there anyone that wants to speak against this item before we move to the proponents? If not, recognize Ken Spaulding and George Stanzio. Let's take 5 minutes on this, if you don't mind.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant, West Point 751 LLC. We have do meet the comprehensive plan. We have met with the residents and neighbors. Had our neighborhood meeting. One person showed up, and they were in favor of it. I think the neighborhood is very pleased with it's out at Bonefish Aldis Grocery Store, 751 West Point office building. They've been very good neighbors. We've been very good neighbors. We would like to say that staff has recommended approval. Your planning commission recommended approval 13-0. We think this provides another additional positive opportunity for that particular development. Thank you.
George has waived his comments. Is there anyone else who wants to speak on this item, this being a public hearing matter? Let reflect no one else has to speak. The matter is back before the council. I'll close the public hearing. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll move to item 20, consistency statement.
Move the consistency statement.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Item 22, street closing, Acadia Street and Dressam Avenue, street closing 15-0007 and 15-0008.
Thank you, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. This is a request from Bernadette Chastine to close 41,323 square feet of public right-of-way, comprising portions of Acadia Street and Dressam Avenue. The subject site is located to the east of Northgate Park and the Ellerby Creek Trail. Both of these streets are open and are currently considered paper streets. There is no physical street there. The streets are bordered by four different property owners, including the city of Durham. Each property would receive land along their street frontage to the center line of the street, as seen on the attached street closing plats, which are attachment 4 in your packet. No issues were raised during the review of this request, which included the General Services Real Estate Division and the Parks and Recreation Department. If the request is approved, Ms. Chastine hopes to construct a single-family structure on property owned by Owen Sinan. Staff has no issues with the proposal and recommends the closure of these rights-of-way. And I'm happy to answer any questions the council may have.
You've heard the staff report. Are there questions, comments on the staff report? Is anyone in the audience who wants to speak on this item? This being a public hearing. Let the record reflect no one in the public asked to speak. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? We close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Okay. Item 23, comprehensive plan amendment, Cornwallis Road property, 3A15000012. And before you do that, I just want to make sure I've got everyone that has signed up to speak on this item. I have four persons that have signed up to speak as proponents of this. Is there anyone else who wants to speak on this item that's a proponent? I've got Patrick Biker, Lau Overcash, Jim Stewart, and Fran Feinberg. Is anyone else who wants to speak in as a proponent? Okay, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I have 10 persons that have signed up to speak in opposition to this development. I'm going to call your names because I'm trying to figure out how much time we allocate for this. Christina Siegman, Kathy Barrington, Curtis Richardson, Patricia Halpin, Tom Strucker, Gary Patillo, I know I missed some of the names, Lewis Carson, Raymond Weston, Karen Proust, and Ellen Pizer. Now, is anyone else that wants to speak in opposition whose name I didn't mangle or didn't call? Okay. Someone in the back? In opposition of? Okay. All right, well, let's do this. We'll start off giving 3 minutes each to those who are opposed, which is 33 minutes, and likewise, we give 33 minutes to the proponents. Staff report.
Good evening. I'm Grace Smith with the Planning Department. This plan amendment is associated with the zoning map change case Z15-00031. This request includes all or portions of 18 parcels on the south side of West Cornwallis Road between Welcome Drive and US 15501, located at 2417 Cornwallis Road on the south side of West Cornwallis between Welcome Drive and 15501. I think I just repeated myself and I apologize for that. This site is located in the suburban tier and is not located in a protected watershed. The plan amendment request is requesting that the future land use map designation of 6.10 acres of commercial and 4.2 acres of low density residential and 16.24 acres of medium density residential, which is a total of 26.54 acres, be changed to low to medium density residential, which would allow for residential development between 4 and 8 dwelling units per acre. Staff recommends approval of this request based on the proposed land use patterns meeting the 4 criteria for plan amendments. And the Planning Commission heard this case on February 9th and recommended denial with a vote of 10-3. And staff is available for questions.
Thank you. You've heard the staff report. This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. I would ask first of the council, are there any questions? If not, we'll proceed with the proponents. They have 30 minutes, and we have 4 people who signed up to speak, mm-hmm. and I'll let you divide your time. Patrick Biker.
Yes.
Lau Overcash, Jim Stewart, and Fran Feinberg.
Yeah, we're waiting for the PowerPoint to come up, Mayor. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of the City Council. My name is Patrick Biker. I live at 2614 Stewart Drive. I'm an attorney with Morningstar Law Group in Durham. Along with my colleague, Neil Ghosh, I'm here tonight representing Pulte Homes for this comprehensive plan amendment. With us tonight are our traffic engineer, Lyle Overcash, our real estate broker, Jim Stewart of Stewart, Martin & McCoy, Bob Anderson from Pulte, and Fran Feinberg, one of the longtime property owners who grew up at this location along Cornwallis Road. As you know, this site is near the intersection of 15501 and West Cornwallis. Just to provide a little context, to the west of the area lies the Colony Park subdivision built in the 1960s. 15501 lies directly adjacent to the east of the property, and the Colony Hills townhomes built in the 1980s are to the south. Filing to the north upstream is Duke Forest. We very much appreciate the Planning Department's recommendation of approval, and I just have a couple key points to add to the staff presentation. First, this proposed plan amendment provides exactly the kind of transition that represents good land use planning. It's important to note that this property has over 1,200 feet of frontage along 15501 bypass, a limited access freeway. And across the freeway, there are 18 acres designated for industrial development, currently utilized for self-storage. Directly adjacent to the south is a townhouse community that is designated for 6 to 12 units per acre. Our application for low-medium residential at 48 units per acre is the reasonable and appropriate transition from the low-density residential to the west, the freeway and the industrial to the east, and the medium density to the south. Second, this plan amendment yields a significant decrease in the development intensity on this site before the council this evening. Our community invested significant resources in 2005 for the creation of our future land use map. That future land use map was reviewed by the JCCPC, the Planning Commission, the City Council, and the County Commissioners. Long story short, the current land use designations support up to 279 dwelling units on this assemblage. The majority of this assemblage, over 16 acres, is designated for medium density, which is 6 to 12 units per acre. Medium density usually means townhouses and garden apartments. such as this development in Parkwood, which is approximately 9 units per acre. We are reducing that residential density significantly and removing the commercial designation on over 6 acres. This reduction is important for environmental considerations, which I think you may well hear about from persons here tonight. It is vital to note that this area is not within a watershed overlay, since it is more than 7 miles north from the edge of Jordan Lake. Accordingly, there would be no impervious surface limitation on this assemblage unless a development plan were before the council, as is the case tonight. As you can see, our requested comp plan amendment reduces the development potential of this site to 218 units. And I'd be remiss if I did not point out our zoning map change next on the agenda requests only 126 new single-family homes. For all these reasons, we respectfully ask for your approval tonight, and our next speaker is our traffic engineer, Lyle Overcash.
Good evening. My name is Lyle Overcash. I'm managing director with VHB in Raleigh, North Carolina. I've been with VHB for 15 years and a traffic engineer for over 20 years. I have a Bachelor of Science from North Carolina State University and specialize in transportation and licensed professional engineer in North Carolina. I've worked on many projects in Durham, most recently a lot of school projects for Durham Public Schools, including Lucas Middle, W.G. Pearson, Creekside, and Jordan High. Real briefly, you see in front of you the excerpt from the staff report that shows the actual decrease in traffic generated by the proposed designation when you're comparing it to the original designation. And you also can see by the 4,800, the volume of road currently on Cornwallis Road and the current capacity, which is 12,700 based on the city's numbers. Based on my professional experience, I do not see any congestion or safety issues arising from the proposed development before council this evening. This plan amendment actually yields a reduction in trip generation, and there is no change in overall level of service for any intersections in the study area. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Let's do it.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of council. My name is Jim Stewart, and I reside at 2227 Parkside Drive here in Durham. I was born in Durham and have been a lifelong resident of this great city. I've been an active member of the Durham real estate community for over 25 years, and it has been my privilege to be the real estate advisor to the owners of this land for over 6 years. I'd just like to cite two recent articles in the media. The first was in The Economist in March 12th. It talked about Durham. It says, Durham is the focus of an article in the March 12th issue, and it talked about the success Durham has experienced, in part due to investment in infrastructure. They even discussed the light rail project that's being proposed. I would contrast that article with an article in the March 29th edition of the News and Observer, which discussed the growing housing shortage across the Triangle region. It is evident that Durham needs more inventory of single-family housing, both affordable and non. In my professional opinion, what is before council tonight represents the highest and best use of this property, and I ask you to agree with the decision of our planning department. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, Council, and citizens. My name is Frances Feinberg, Frances Marley Feinberg. I reside at 1410 Northeast 103rd Street, Miami Shores, Florida. My extended family owns this property that is in this proposal. It's where I grew up. I remember riding horses on the farm next door and playing in the woods. I also remember when our neighbors sold their land so that Colony Park subdivision could be built. We were sad to see our neighbors go, but we did not protest the development. I love this city. Durham has meant so much to me and to my family. It's a great place, evidenced by all the people that are moving here. That is why my father chose to start the book exchange here in downtown Durham. My family operated the book exchange for over 75 years before we had to close in 2009 due to the recession and other issues. I'm glad to see that things are picking up here in Durham, but taxes have really gone up. It is difficult to maintain vacant land, which is basically what we have, with the tax revaluation, which I just got a couple months ago. And I see that this tax increase is really 54%. That increase is just untenable for vacant land. We want to see a new neighborhood that will welcome the next generation of home buyers to Durham. It's a great place to live. It's a great place to raise your family. We hope it will be for many more families. I hope you support this petition, and I thank all of you for giving me the chance to speak.
Mayor Bell, unless the council has any questions, we'll reserve the remainder of our time for rebuttal. Thank you.
I would just comment that the last slide that you put up in terms of the parcel increase, it's not a tax increase, it's valuation.
Valuation, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Doesn't necessarily translate to...
We hope the tax rate goes down. We're hoping and praying the tax rate goes down.
We hope it'll go up 51%. Having said that, I'm going to recognize persons who have signed up to speak in opposition to this. And I'm going to call your name if you can come to the podium to my right. And each have 3 minutes. Christina Sigmund, Kathy Barrington, Curtis Richardson, Patricia Halpin, Tom Strutsaker, Gary Patillo, Lewis Carson, Raymond Weston, Karen Pruce, and Ellen Pitzer. And the gentleman back there, if you can get a yellow card and sign up, please, and come behind it. And as you come to speak, if you again just pronounce your name and your address. And the clock is in front of you in terms of the time.
Wow, that's quite a line. Hey, my name is Christina Sigmund. Good evening. 2910 Friendship Road. I represent the views of all but a handful of the 120 homeowners in the Colony Park subdivision, which is next to the development that we're talking about, or the potential development. I'd like to take a moment, since we've got a big house here, to ask those with concerns about this potential amendment and rezoning to raise your hand. I was going to say stand, but people are already standing. Thank you. Before I start, I'd like to make it clear that Colony Park recognizes that the use of this land will change. However, we feel a new development should be compatible with the surrounding area and represent an asset to Durham. The problem is not this site, but the plan for it. Colony Park met multiple times with Pulte Homes and asked for specific commitments, but they were not adequately addressed. I can advance this. Here we go. Here's how this development would fit into the surrounding area, which is largely wooded. Nearly a third of the property is in the floodplain of Sandy Creek, compressing the area that can be developed. This plan includes a 30-foot buffer with Colony Park. It's too small when adjoining a row of two-story homes spaced 10 feet apart with backyards, not much deeper than this room, probably not even as deep as this room, at 20 to 30 feet. The draft site plan shows that the density of the portion, of the development adjoining Colony Park would be more than twice the overall proposed density of 4.1 homes per acre at 8 to 10 homes per acre. There would be 2 to 5 homes adjoining each Colony Park lot at the boundary. The draft site, in the future land use map, which is shown here, the section of land beside Colony Park is planned as very low density development to provide a transition. A density of 8 to 10 homes per acre at the boundary does not provide this reasonable transition. We were directed to a Pulte development in Charlotte as an example of what is proposed. In these slides, the development is shown on the left and Colony Park on the right. This design is not consistent with any of the adjoining areas, and I do not know of one resident along the full length of Tryon Road that is satisfied with the proposed buffer and transition or the effect of this transition on their property values. The proposed development includes up to 70% impervious surface area and clear cutting. This is the tree coverage now, and this area in white is where it will be clear cut. The plan described to us by Pulte is to create constructed wetlands in the floodplain, and even more clear cutting will be needed in the process. They will clear cut 88% of the entire area, or maybe 75 to 80% if there were no clear cutting.
Thank you.
Sure. You can see we have a flooding problem.
Kathy Barrington.
And I will need a little help getting out of this and into.
You can just minimize this.
Thank you. Is that minimized?
And find yours. Here we go. And then do.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Kathy Barrington, an applied environmental scientist with experience in land use planning and stormwater management, recently retired from NC State University. I live at 1708 Woodburn Road. As proposed, this development will produce significant negative water quality impacts to Sandy Creek, thereby increasing state-mandated mitigation costs for the city of Durham. Two elements of the plan will have most negative stormwater impacts. These are the soil-destroying clear-cut and mass grading, site preparation, and the siting of stormwater detention features within the Sandy Creek floodplain. Soil preservation is particularly important on Durham's clay soils. Clear-cutting and mass grading reduce imperviousness to near zero, increasing flood hazard and pollutant loads. It takes decades for soils to regenerate sufficiently for effective stormwater infiltration and pollution removal. Durham's UDO emphasizes the need, quote, to preserve and maintain the natural floodplain in an undisturbed vegetated state, unquote. Well-designed constructed wetlands can be an excellent stormwater management practice, but should not replace well-established floodplain forest. In fact, most of the point of such constructed stormwater features is keeping water out of the channels in the floodplains. The city of Durham recognizes that pollution prevention is much cheaper than pollution remediation and is actively promoting low-impact development stormwater management practices as a cost-effective way to meet state-required improvements in water quality entering Falls and Jordan Lakes. The importance of this is demonstrated by your October approval of $1 million for a stormwater wetland at the Duke Diet and Fitness Center. The proposed development is just downstream of Duke's $5 million project to improve water quality in Sandy Creek. Professor Kurt Richardson will be speaking on that, I assume. Pulte Homes could greatly reduce negative stormwater impacts through low-impact development practices, such as leaving patches of undisturbed forest in strategic areas and adding stormwater infiltration features and drainages and along roads. Durham's existing ordinances are permissive of such practices, but do not require them. So we cannot assume that the development review process will ensure adequate stormwater management. The city's minimum requirements encode outdated science shown 20 years ago to actually increase flood hazard and pollution. 20-year-old development practices do not meet Durham's current needs. The Planning Commission, in recommending against this plan, noted that the city can negotiate with developers to get commitments on details of site design and stormwater management before granting rezoning requests. This is a reasonable middle ground approach that is permissive of new development while also meeting Durham's needs in limiting transfer of cleanup costs to taxpayers. Therefore, I strongly recommend that you not grant this rezoning request unless and until Pulte Homes presents a detailed stormwater management plan that includes low impact development practices. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Kirk Richardson.
Good evening, Mayor Bell and City Manager Bonfield and the Council. I'm Kurt Richardson. I live at 717 Anderson Street in Durham, North Carolina. I'm a professor at Duke, and I'm also director of the Duke University Wetland Center. I believe I passed out a little letter that I wrote to the council and the pictures. So since 1999, I've been working on restoring both streams and wetlands in the Sandy Creek watershed. We've done about 20 acres of wetland restoration and about 10,000 plus feet of stream. That has resulted in about 500 tons per year of sediment reduction, 64% of nitrogen, and 30% of phosphorus from 1,200 acres of Durham and 240 acres at Duke, all at a cost of about $5 to $6 million, $5 million from the Clean Water Management Trust and about $1 million from Duke. Sandy Creek is on the 303D list for water quality and feeds directly into the Jordan Reservoir. So recently I visited this site. I'm actually with my class, I do restoration. I use the students as sort of my legs and arms on this. And actually when I looked at this site, it has an amazing forest already on it. It's a really a wonderful site. And also has going by a part of Sandy Creek that was basically ditched by the Corps of Engineers. This site, when you look at it in terms of restoration or development, it has potential for fantastic restoration and connections with some of the existing forests and trails, but it also has some development potential. However, if you really look at this Pulte aspect, which I've looked at the plan, 70% roughly of impervious surface, this would degrade the water quality was mentioned. It would negate a lot of the work that's been done upstream that is basically helping the city of Durham on its water quality. And also I'm greatly concerned, since my specialty for the last 35 years is wetlands, is the proposal to put two small wetlands in the bottom area to treat this water is a little bit naive, because if you look at what's there now and those two pictures I have attached to that, you'll see the flooding on December 30th. There were houses, if you look in the background, there's water up to the houses. That beautiful floodplain now has to have some stream restoration. That flooding is a pretty dramatic problem, and it's filled with sediment and nutrients. Two small wetland areas, if you cut down all the trees, will make this a far worse situation, to say the least. So something could be done with this property, but not high-density development to make more runoff and more problems. So with that, I would say that this project has to have some rethinking, and it has to have some changes. Otherwise, I think the city's going to suffer in the long term when it has to face the Jordan rules. Thank you.
Patrick Halpin.
Yes, Patrick Halpin, not Patricia. Live at 1623 Shawnee Street. I'm a faculty member at the Nicholas School of the Environment, and I'm a member of the Duke Forest Advisory Committee. Duke Forest has been one of the longest standing research forests in the country and has been actively managing land since 1931. Duke Forest maintains around 7,000 acres of land primarily in Durham and Orange counties for the purpose of environmental science research. These lands also provide a wide range of ecosystem services, including wildlife habitat, watershed protection, noise reduction, urban heat island reduction, and significant green space and recreational benefits to our community. The Duke Forest Advisory Committee advises the managers of Duke Forest and the Duke University administration on forest land management decisions. Duke Forest is one of the directly neighboring properties in this case. The parcel of Duke Forest directly adjacent to the proposed development covers 907 acres of forest land that represents one of the closest parcels of forest in the city of Durham, also to the main campus of the university, and specifically acts as the forest buffer to the Duke University Lemur Center. This parcel, combined with other portions of the Durham Division of Duke Forest, provides approximately 2 miles of contiguous forest corridor north of the project proposed along the western edge of 15501 South. At present, this undeveloped forest corridor continues south through the proposed project area, eventually joining up to the 100-acre Sandy Creek Park. The proposed development places a high concentration of housing units and a loss of standing tree cover and proposed 70% impervious surface area directly breaking this long-established natural forest corridor. The adjacent Duke Forest land is identified in the future land use map as recreation and open space land. The planning policy 2.3.1A specifically calls for gradual and orderly transitions between land use densities. However, the planning department assessment of this rezoning request appears to only directly assess west to east transitions between the existing single family property in Colony Park eastward through the proposed parcels. Previously, in the proponent's presentation, they showed a map that showed an arrow going west to east. It did not consider the open space area going north to south. And so this abrupt transition between the undeveloped recreation open space land to the north of the proposed development and additional recreation open space lands to the south has not been directly or adequately addressed in this process. It's our opinion that placing the proposed development between two areas of recreation open space land use in the north-south direction does not represent a gradual and orderly transition as stipulated by Planning Policy 2.3.1A. This ongoing fragmentation through abrupt transitions to incompatible land uses degrades our ability to defend the values of these lands as research forest and open space. We've been maintaining our undeveloped forest since 1931. Encroaching development of this type threatens our ability to maintain the long-term natural and social benefits of this forest management to the Durham community into the future. Thank you.
My name is Tom Strusaker.
Thank you.
I live at 2953 Welcome Drive. I am a retired biologist with more than 50 years of experience conducting ecological studies. I sent a letter to all of you explaining the many reasons this amendment and rezoning should be rejected. Some of the most important reasons concern the environment. The properties being considered are ecologically sensitive and inappropriate for the kind of development being proposed. For example, 25% of the land is in a floodplain and flood fringe where no disturbance should be allowed. Furthermore, there's a 50-foot drop between the highest and lowest points to be developed. My understanding is that the developers wish to level this land. Moving this much soil around is certainly going to cause profound ecological impacts. And finally, the properties border Sandy Creek. Any additional pollution, as we've heard, will threaten all the $5 million efforts of Duke University upstream. Clear-cutting 87 to 90% of this land will remove thousands of trees, something on the order of between 3,000 and 7,000 trees, including many in the floodplain and flood fringe. Not only will this have a negative impact on these and neighboring properties, but it runs contrary to Durham's tree planting goals. As you know, trees have many benefits. They act as a sponge, taking up water, thereby reducing stormwater runoff and flooding. An acre of forest can absorb between 2 and 4 million gallons of water in a 7-month growing period. Just imagine the impact of clear-cutting 35 acres of forest. You also know that trees are important for natural air cleaners, removing major greenhouse gases and filtering out particulate matter that cause serious health problems. The clear cut and mass grading proposed in this project are contrary to many of Durham's excellent planning policies. One of the most important of these policies is the LID, low impact development. This is not a low impact development project. I'm not opposed to all types of development, but I am arguing against development that uses clear cutting and mass grading. Low impact development that retains as many mature trees as possible and fits into the existing landscape will benefit all of us. I am urging you to implement the policies of Durham's UDO and comprehensive plan. Durham and your constituents deserve a much better kind of development than this. Please reject this amendment and rezoning proposal. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Bell and council members. My name is Lewis Carson. My address is 2510 Lanier Place in Durham. Before I retired last year, I was an associate director in the Office of Institutional Research and Planning at North Carolina State University. I'm very concerned about the traffic problems that will result if this rezoning proposal is approved. The proposed development is situated at a major 15501 bypass intersection. The intersection has four short ramps. This is the only intersection on two-lane Cornwallis Road that provides access to the 15501 bypass, therefore I-40 and the freeway as well. We contend that this site is inadequate to support the desired density. The City Planning Department projected an increase of 1,299 daily trips resulting from this development. Measured traffic by NCDOT in 2013 put this specific section of Cornwallis Road at 4,800 daily trips. Add the two together, you get over 6,000 daily trips from this development and other traffic. My first concern is that the additional daily trips will increase the hazards at the 15501 ramps and stoplights. The short ramps are hazardous at times now, and the increased traffic will make that worse. During our neighborhood-conducted traffic study, we observed that traffic going east on Cornwallis Road in the morning, peak hours, stopped at the traffic light, often backs up to the first proposed development entrance, and sometimes could reach the second entrance. These congested entrances would be used by more than 250 additional vehicles at peak hours from this development. The proposed development includes turn lanes at the two entrances. Based on observation of stop traffic at peak hours, the turn lanes would be inadequate to handle traffic when they are blocked by backed up traffic. My second concern is for the safety of school buses and fire engines. The public schools of Durham have 19 daily buses on this stretch of road. The fire department recorded an average of 120 calls per month to one or both of the fire engines at station number 11. They would both be using this short stretch of road. My third concern is for the safety of vehicles using Woodburn Road and other parts of Duke Forest. The peak hour rushes currently produce an extra traffic cutting through Woodburn to get to Academy Road. The intersection of Woodburn and Cornwallis is at the top of a hill with limited visibility and no left turn lanes. That's another increased hazard. Based on our experience, study, and research, we contend that the site for the proposed development does not meet the policy objective of the UDO in that traffic safety would be jeopardized. This is not the right development for this site. Please reject this rezoning request. Thank you.
Before you begin, I had a Gary Patullo. Okay, so I can stretch your name. All right, thank you. Go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, City Council members. My name is Ellen Pizer, and I live in Colony Park at 2506 Tryon Road with my husband and young sons. Our house is situated on 3/4 acre. If the proposed development is approved, my backyard would face 5 housing units. While this is daunting and would be a drastic change from our current wooded view, this is not what disturbs me most about Pulte's current proposal. What is most upsetting, besides the significant environmental impacts already mentioned, is how incongruous this development is to the surrounding neighborhoods that all border Duke Forest. This area is such a special, unique part of Durham. It deserves to be developed thoughtfully with a low density impact to be in harmony with the existing houses, forest, and wildlife that is already here. I grew up in Raleigh and my husband in Charlotte. We very consciously chose to live in Durham because of the values we feel this city represents. I believe Durham can be a model city that differentiates itself from others by consciously expanding, upholding the use of its comprehensive plan, not becoming a mishmash of disorganized development that reflects the best interests of developers rather than its residents. Please consider voting against the amendment and the rezoning of this area. And at the very least, consider making specific contingencies that would protect the already existing community and wetlands. Colony Park has been unsuccessful in our efforts to negotiate with Pulte and to have them accommodate our current concerns. Requests to adapt their design to be responsible and considerate, particularly in regard to transitioning neighborhoods and the grave stormwater flooding issues, have been ignored. I want to believe that the voice of Durham citizens matter. We are now unable to petition against this kind of development. I look to Durham's leaders to be our safeguard. Durham needs more housing. It needs more affordable housing. It also needs to be considerate of its residents already living here. I believe this is the purpose of Durham's comprehensive plan. We already have standards set in place to protect the land and its residents so our city can grow and develop responsibly. I am looking to you and urge you, City Council, to uphold these standards. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Good evening. My name is Karen Proust, and I live at 2510 Lanier Place. When the applicant originally requested rezoning of this site, The neighborhood exercised its right to file a protest petition. This would have required a supermajority of the council to approve the rezoning. The applicant then withdrew its application after the Planning Commission denied the rezoning. And the applicant then resubmitted its application. But in the intervening time, the North Carolina legislature took away our right to a protest petition. So our only recourse is our voices here tonight and our presence here tonight. So in your deliberations about the benefits and risks of this proposed development, please keep in mind that if approved, the applicant will take its profit and move on to other projects and other states. The majority landowner will return to Florida. But the citizens of the affected neighborhood will bear the brunt and the cost of the immediate consequences of this density of development at this particular location in close proximity to the 15501 bypass intersection. And all the citizens will bear the consequences of environmental degradation and the cost of downstream pollution and any cost of road improvements that may be required. We ask you then to carefully consider our voices and the number that are present here tonight and consider rejecting this proposal for this particular site. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, council members, citizens. My name is Raymond Weston. I live at 2518 Tryon Road in Colony Woods, Colony Park. I served for 20 years in the United States Air Force. I'm asking you to reject this proposal for rezoning and development. I think that the development and rezoning being proposed by Pucci does not fit in with our neighborhood, and that it will have a negative effect on the attractiveness of my property and probably its value too. This is very important to me because I am retired and have limited income. Do you live in an established community where each home is unique, has a personality of its own, and is located on a beautiful manicured lawn with blooming colorful flowers with mature trees blowing in the wind decorating your yard? That is the neighborhood that I live in, a neighborhood that brings a big smile to your face with a sense of warmth, belonging, and accomplishment, but more importantly, a great sense of security and pride. Think of a cookie-cutter homes no more than 10 feet apart on a tenth of an acre invading your beautiful neighborhood. Now let me ask each of you this question. What would you do if this was your neighborhood? Please preserve our community and reject this proposal for rezoning and development. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Andrew Woods. I am a resident of 2417 West Cornwallis Road. The property that's in question tonight. I have been a resident of that house for the past 4 years while I've been in Divinity School at Duke. I'm now a United Methodist minister here in the Durham area. And I am someone who is dedicated to the preservation of ecologically significant areas. I recognize that my residency within this location might be seen as a conflict of interest, but I want to advise that this is something that we caution you against rezoning this property. As a Christian, I am taught that everything we see is connected to us. Green space in an urban environment is beneficial not only to the health of the local flora and fauna, but to the health of the city as well. As you've already heard by people who are more eloquent and know more about this than I do, our green spaces provide habitat for a variety of animals, as well as helping our environment with soil erosion and our flood areas. The property in question on Cornwallis Road provides an important space of habitat for pollinating animals and plants. The water system it occupies benefits from stronger filtration and less pollutants because of this natural space. While my allergy-prone nose might disagree with this statement, the air you and I breathe each day is dependent upon the animals and the plants that occupy this space currently. Someone said earlier that this is a vacant space, and it is not a vacant space right now. As a minister, I find it theologically significant to our relationship with the natural world. It is my duty to teach that this space of land we occupy is not our own. We are all to be stewards of all that we are given. As the stewards of this community, I urge you to see the value of this property not in the space of housing it might provide, but in the benefits it already provides to the community, which will be lost if not protected. Most importantly, green spaces remind us that as humans, we are part of a vast system called nature. Every decision we make impacts not only our non-human partners on our earth, but it also impacts us directly. As a pastor, I am reminded daily that my well-being is dependent upon the well-being of those around me. As a member of the Durham community, I'm compelled to remind us of those who have no voice and are not able to be here tonight because they're not human. As a student, sometimes I wonder whether my kidney might be more beneficial to me being sold on the black market. But just because I can't see the work that my kidney does not mean that it is unimportant. The same is true about this space. It is more important to Durham as it is than it would be as a space of housing. I'm not without heart for those who need better housing, but we have houses in Durham that are empty. We should look first as a community to how we can be better stewards of the housing that we have now than to seek to destroy that space which is already housing our non-human community. This space is Durham's kidney. It filters pollutants and it provides an integral part of the ecosystem of our area. My name is Andrew Woods, and I ask you to not rezone this property. Thank you for your time.
That concludes all the persons who had signed up to speak in opposition to this item. The proponents now have, how much time do they have? How much? Yield to the proponents. Let me, before you do that, are there questions by members of the council before the proponents come back up? If not, I recognize Patrick Biker.
Good evening again, Mayor Bell, members of the City Council. I would like to certainly emphasize that we view this proposal as good environmental stewardship, and a number of these issues that were brought up by the citizens tonight in opposition are more appropriately addressed at the zoning map change public hearing that is next on your agenda. Having said that, I do want to take issue with a few points. One of them was the assertion that it's been 20 years since Durham updated its stormwater ordinances. That's certainly not my experience. We have been very proactive in adopting strict stormwater ordinances that are tough but fair and appropriate given the location of Durham in not one but two watershed basins. Accordingly, our stormwater ordinances are, to my knowledge, the toughest in the state, and the development community, including Pulte Homes, is ready to comply with them with this proposal. So I do not want to have the council labor under a misapprehension that perhaps there is something wrong with Durham's ordinances. I, for one, do not believe that. I would also like to raise an issue with a letter that was I believe distributed to the City Council, and I believe it may have been also distributed to the it was also distributed to the Planning Commission from Curtis Richardson. I met with Fail Wynn, the Vice President of Durham and Regional Affairs, and to the extent that letter is on Duke letterhead, it should not be construed as an official position of Duke University. Now to address the stormwater issues in more detail is our site engineer, Mr. Jared Edens. And then we will also address the traffic issues and the property valuation issues by Lyle Overcash and Jim Stewart, respectively. Thank you.
Evening, Mayor, City Council. Jared Edens with Edens Land Corp. I've been an engineer in North Carolina for about 19 years. Licensed engineer. A vast majority of my experience has been in Durham. Last 15, 16 years, almost solely in Durham. My firm's based in Durham. I'm very familiar with Durham and the stormwater requirements in Durham. I was jotting some notes down just to discuss some of the issues brought forward by the neighbors. There's been a lot of talk about the cost to Durham. Well, any retrofit cost to the city of Durham for stormwater is just that. It's retrofit cost. It's cost for existing developments that don't have stormwater controls in place now. All of the existing communities around this property, they don't have stormwater ponds, constructed wetlands, wet ponds. There aren't stormwater controls. So any cost that Durham's incurring or will incur is to help clean up Sandy Creek due to projects that were constructed without stormwater controls. This new project will have to comply to Durham's stormwater ordinance, which is very strict. You know, we work in Raleigh, Cary. I used to have an office at the coast. We worked all over. Durham is known as a very strict place, tough place to work stormwater-wise. New projects are not the issue. New projects have to install stormwater ponds that meet the ordinance. New projects have to detain a minimum, have to remove 85% total suspended solids from the impervious areas. New projects had to reduce nitrogen and phosphorus runoff. Existing projects did not have to do that, which is why we're in the position we are today. There's been some discussion of low impact development, shoulder and ditch, water quality swales, things like that. As a licensed engineer in this state, very familiar with the Diener Design Manual and what credits are given for what different devices, simply installing a road with a shoulder and ditch does not meet the stormwater ordinance. It doesn't come close. It doesn't remove the 85% suspended solids. It doesn't remove the nitrogen and phosphorus. It's a nice thought on paper. When you actually read the rules, read the stormwater ordinance, go through the UDO, it doesn't do the trick. You would still have to do stormwater ponds on top of it. Another thing I want to mention, there was some mention of disturbing wetlands, and I know people get the feeling that if there's floodplain on the side, there's automatically a lot of wetlands on the side, jurisdictional wetlands. Well, we paid a professional consultant who does this for a living, who had the core out on the property, who confirmed their findings. There's only 1/10 of an acre of wetlands, jurisdictional wetlands, on the entire property, over the 40-plus acres, 1/10 of an acre of wetlands. And the last thing I want to point out again, and it's just reemphasizing what Patrick had mentioned earlier, we're not in a watershed here. We're not in a primary. We're not in a secondary. We've had many projects approved here in Durham much closer to Jordan Lake than this project that had to meet the same stormwater ordinance that we're meeting with this one. So again, I'd be glad to answer any questions you have. I appreciate your time.
Good evening again. Laura Vercash with VHB. I think the gentleman had a couple comments concerning traffic. When looking at daily traffic volumes, we don't add the entire volume to one point. Traffic comes out of the development and it will head in two different directions. We estimated, based on our counts, we did 13 hours of counts at each intersection in our study area from Welcome Drive, including the interchange ramps. We estimate a 60-40 split, so about 60% heading towards the interchange, which equates about 750 to 800 vehicles per day. So if you add that to the 4,800, then you would result about 5,500, which is still less than half of the traffic capacity of the road. So still well under. You did correctly identify the worst intersection that we found was in the AM peak hour at the southbound ramps. It was a level service C. And the rest were B's and A's in the study area, which is, I do a lot of work in Durham, it's kind of unusual. But compared to background conditions and to build conditions, the development will only add an average of 2 seconds of delay on. I don't write the software, I just use it. So that's all I have.
Again, Jim Stewart, 2227 Parkside Drive here in Durham. I rise to speak to the question of property values. I know there's concern that this project will decrease property values in the neighborhood. We've done some analysis of the properties that would border the western boundary of this project. And there's an average of $294,888 is the current tax value of those homes that will border this project. The average price of the home sale proposed by Poulter will be $330,000 and above. And it's of the type of house that is very popular with people moving to the area. The large lot types of subdivision are very much desirable by some. It's certainly the people that occupy those homes are very very happy with those homes. But the new proposals have to fit current marketing proposals, and that's the design of the homes that will be there. But again, the property values will be in excess of $330,000 that what will be sold in this property. Thank you.
Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of council, just to wrap up, again, a number of these issues, such as the impervious surface limitation, the buffer between the proposed new neighborhood and Colony Park, and other issues can be addressed at the zoning map change public hearing next on your agenda. And so we are open, certainly ready, willing, and able to address those issues, and we think make this a strong development. I want to keep in mind what the staff report showed, which is a dramatic decrease in the development intensity of this property before the council tonight. We are asking you to remove a commercial designation on over 6 acres. We are asking you to look at a development plan that will restrict impervious surface where this is an area of Durham that has no impervious surface limitations. And so, looking at all those issues, we again appreciate the staff recommendation for approval and respectfully ask you to do just that. Again, if you have any other questions, we'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Welcome. Are there questions by members of the council? I recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mayor Bell.
Yes, sir.
I guess I'm trying to weigh the comments that the proponents have put forth in terms of being the threat to Sandy Creek and mm-hmm. to Jordan Reservoirs. Mm-hmm. That threat is at least 7 miles away. Mm-hmm. And you say that there are provisions that the new developments, the stormwater mm-hmm. controls that you would put forth, would that, do you, in your mind, I guess, mm-hmm. outweigh the items that have been put forth by lots of these people who have been, who are environmental mm-hmm. Experts, mm-hmm. Even if they are on the wrong letterhead.
Correct. Yes, sir.
The comments that they've made, mm-hmm. how do you balance what you are saying would be the actual controls that would mm-hmm. prevent what they are saying?
Yes. I can answer that at one level, and then our site engineer, Mr. Edens, can go into any specifics on that. But I would ask the council to reflect on the fact that new development is not really the problem with water quality issues. The problem we have with water quality issues is all the existing developments. So if you think of this part of town, if you think of where the TJ Maxx is, the all the development along Garrett Road, all the development at New Hope Commons, there is just an awful lot of asphalt that was developed in the 60s, 70s, 80s, even the Colony Woods development. There are no stormwater controls whatsoever. And so what happens is if a car goes to, my wife shops at TJ Maxx a lot. If a car goes there and transmission fluid or oil leaks out, the rain comes down, it goes straight into the New Hope Creek and into Jordan Lake because that was an older development and it's never been retrofit. These new developments have literally state-of-the-art stormwater controls. Mr. Edens referred to them, and again, if you want more detail on it, I'm sure he'd be happy to give it to you. But the problem is not the new development, the problem is the existing development. And therefore, we would take issue with the characterization that this development, which again is we're treating it as though it's in the watershed by saying it's only gonna have 70% impervious surface, we could go lower than that. But we're treating it as though it is in the watershed basin, even though, as you referenced, it's quite a few miles outside of the watershed overlay. And so I hope that answers your question. If it doesn't and you need more specifics, then Mr. Edens would be happy to provide those.
And I guess I'd like to follow up by asking if you, if Pulte Homes or any of you all involved would be willing to sign or be responsible for any litigation that might come from the failure of the stormwater controls that you all are proposing.
Well, the city attorney is very familiar with this, but those facilities have to be bonded by the developer and then by the homeowners association. So that provides the city with the surety necessary in perpetuity, is that correct, Mr. Baker, for the stormwater facilities to be operating as they are designed to operate?
Yes, Mr. Davis, and just to add some more information on what Patrick was talking about, you also have annual inspections every year that have to be performed by a licensed engineer. We do a lot of work in Durham. Durham has changed the stormwater ordinance several times over the years. It seems like every time it changes, it gets more strict than it was before. That's just sort of the way it is. As an engineer, a pro-development kind of guy, I often frown at when new rules come out, but we have to meet the new rules, and that's how it works. But when we design a project in my office, I've got a small staff, I've got 20 people. Every project that we do is focused on stormwater. The stormwater design on the project drives the design. Where does the water go? How do you treat the water? How do you meet the code? And everything else just sort of evolves around that. You start at your low points, you get your devices in place, and you work backwards from there. And in Durham, it's not just the design of the facility. I don't design it at site plan, I don't pull a permit and walk away and say, all right, we're out. That's not how it works. You design it, you permit it, you build it, you inspect it. Not just by me, we have to hire a geotechnical engineer to inspect the dam of the facility, to do compaction tests on the dam to make sure that it's never gonna fail. I have to be out there, I've gotta take photos, I've gotta document it. At the very end of the project, I have to submit what we call an as-built plan. I say, okay, this is what I designed a year ago, here's what I built. I have to prove to staff all over again that what was built actually matches what was designed. And if it doesn't match, they won't close out the project. They hold COs, they'll hold building permits, and you have to, at the end of the day, you have to build what you say you're gonna build, and it has to function the way it's supposed to function, or you can't ever finish your project. So I just wanna let you know, it's a very strict process. The majority of my staff's time and design is dealing with stormwater, and I hope that gives you some comfort that when we say we will meet the rules, it's not just wham, bam, and we're out. It's a long process, and it's a lot of rules. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Mayor Bell.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Mr. Medlin, I'm aware that a lot of what we've been talking about, listening to so far, has really more related to the zoning. And I wonder if you could just take a moment and say, look, these are the issues you focus on for a plan amendment. Bring us back to the plan amendment, if you will.
Sure. For the council's benefit, a plan amendment is simply an amendment to the future land use map of the comprehensive plan that establishes a broad land use category for each property within Durham. Obviously, in this case, the applicant is requesting to modify that broad land use designation from its current commercial and low density residential designations to allow for low medium density residential densities to potentially be allowed at this site. The plan amendment does not give any rights whatsoever. It does not establish zoning. That comes through the subsequent action that will come before council next. At this point, you should be looking at it from, for lack of a better description, a 50,000 foot level. Saying, is this an appropriate density of land use or appropriate land use in general that should be on this piece of property? Is this the, you know, that simple?
Thank you. I want to comment that a number of the, I'm totally sympathetic to the concerns I've heard tonight, but they relate to Duke's, the importance to Duke of the property, the importance to the adjoining neighbors of the property, and a lot of the comments, not all of them. And so I think it's really important to understand that if those are the major concerns, then like Duke has an enormous endowment. And if this is important to downstream properties of Duke, then I would want to see Duke step up. And because the person who shouldn't bear the cost of keeping the property the way it is, or of the benefits that accrue to the neighbors or to Duke, the person who shouldn't bear that cost is the current landowner. That said, I want to say that, first of all, we're out of easy development property in Durham. Everything that we have now is going to be problematic. And this site, in particular, is located adjacent to 15501. So if their traffic engineer, I heard laughter, if their traffic engineer is wrong, the area that's impacted is much smaller than if this site was some distance from 15501. It's also located in proximity to employment centers, which is important because we want to keep people from driving as much as we can. So I do think that this property is not, it's not appropriate for there to be commercial on any part of this property. And I do think that the requested plan amendment is appropriate given its location. Now I understand the comment about the transitions north to south versus east to west, but again, those kind of go to the benefits that accrue largely to Duke, to and particularly to Duke in that case. So I don't.
Let's maintain a little order, please, if you don't mind.
So, and I will point out that I have respectfully listened to every person who spoke, and I would only ask the same. I will also caution you not to be, I have seen people get up and leave after the plan amendment. There are two cases tonight, and the plan amendment has to do with the future use, not as the planning director said, not any rights on the property as it currently exists. So I do support the plan amendment, and we'll talk more about the rezoning when we get to that. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You're welcome. Are there other questions? I have a question of the developers. If you look at the proposed change map, future land use map proposed, can you tell me why you took out the low density residential as a part of your overall plan map?
It was to make the overall aggregate unit count come to 4.1, the overall density come to 4.131, Mayor Bell, which yields 126 dwelling units on the assemblage. The irony, perhaps, of this proposal is that the council recently adopted changes to stream buffer calculations. And if we were applying for this comprehensive plan amendment today, we would actually be coming in at, Jared, I think you said it was 3.8. So it actually would be between 0 and 4 on that. So it was to allow for a density of 4.131 and 126 dwelling units, as is will be presented in the next case, Mayor Bell.
Say something,
Steve. Just wanted to clarify Mr. Biker's comment. We have not modified the Unified Development Ordinance at this point. State law basically was changed with the most recent session law, which would,
I know the council was updated. I know, I understand the council was updated on it. I apologize for the for that, but I remember, I understand the council heard about that change.
Councilor Schuller, do you have a comment? No, you can go ahead and speak to that.
I just wanted to ask further about the low density residential, Patrick, at the western end.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, one of the concerns of the neighbors is this area.
Yes, sir.
And the We've heard a lot about transitions tonight, and I have some thoughts about those, but at this point, why not leave that low-density residential as a transition area?
Well, unfortunately, Councilmember Shule, that parcel, while it does not really have much of any frontage on Cornwallis Road, as the parcel's boundary lines go from north to south, it encompasses quite a bit of the property. So I apologize, I don't have the staff report in front of me, but if that acreage were not allowed in this, it would again have an adverse effect on the project, and which again translates into the ability of the project to support affordable housing, to support the turn lanes that Mr. Overcash referred to, and these other issues that are benefits that will be addressed at the zoning map change stage. It simply wasn't feasible from looking at this as a holistic development to exclude that because it was a relatively large parcel. There are 18 parcels in the assemblage, and it was one of the larger ones. So you would have been taking out a significant amount of the development. And again, if you look at the zoning map change application, it's only for PDR 4.131. So it's really only 0.131 above the 4 units per acre.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt, and I'll come back.
I'm sorry, yes. My yes, math sir. Is failing me at this hour. But if this little strip was left at the lower density, and the plan amendment requested is 4 to 8 units per acre, so you could theoretically go all the way up to 8 units per acre and still be fine. So
that's true.
Twice you've now said that this was needed in order to be able to plan the project, the number of units, but I can't see how that.
No, I see your point, but it's if you took out that parcel to the left that's designated for 0 to 4, again, with the new stream buffer standards, it would have been a moot point. But if you took out that acreage, it would have knocked the rest of it probably below. Given that our request is for 4.131, it would have knocked that below. I don't think it would have been able to attain 4 units per acre if that were left at 4.
Are there other questions, comments on that? I guess troubles me some with the proposed amendment, and I sympathize with the transition that the neighborhood is speaking about, and it seems to me that allows that type of transition had you left that low density rather than stepping it up to the medium density. And so that causes issues for me.
I see your point, Mayor, and I wish those stream buffer standards had changed a little bit earlier, but we can't change the past.
Okay, let me ask, are there other questions, comments on this item? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing. I'm just asking for comments from, if the developer, wants to ask the developer something, someone asks the people in opposition something, otherwise I'm going to close, because we've given adequate time to both sides. So unless someone raises a question from the council, I'm going to bring the matter back before the ma'am, I appreciate that. Everything's on the record. Are there other comments by members of the council, questions? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing. The matter's back before the council on this item. And I guess I'm looking for some direction relative to the council. If you fail to do that, I don't normally make motions, but here or not, I'm going to call a question on this item, and the proposal is to make the change. Is there a second to that? There's no second to it. Nobody's making any comments at all. I'm going to propose the Planning Commission recommendation, denial 10-3 on February 9th, 2016, based on consideration of adopted plans, compatibility impacts, and site dimensions, and information here at the public hearings. That would be my motion. Is there a second to the motion for discussion? If not, it's going to die. It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there questions on the motion? Okay, well, let me make clear what happens. If you vote for this, then you'll be supporting the Planning Commission recommendation. If you vote against it, then you wouldn't be supporting it. I recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to vote for this motion to support the Planning Commission's recommendation, but I do want to say some things to the folks that are here tonight. I think this is a close call. I think that there are a lot of things to recommend this. And I don't want to give the neighborhood by my vote tonight the idea that I don't support development on this parcel. I actually do support development on this parcel. And I also support a reasonable amount of density. My major concerns actually go to the zoning. Well, at some point, the land use map, in the sense that the buffer that I just mentioned to Patrick, and a couple of the zoning issues. But I will say, I'm going to say a couple things that don't really bother me. So when this comes back to us again, I just want to be clear about this. The traffic. This is a road that is, frankly, pretty empty. I drive it a lot, and I've been driving a lot, particularly lately, to sort of check it out. And I will say that there's a lot of capacity on this road, and I do not think that the density that's proposed would have a significant negative effect. I will also say that the stormwater. I understand the stormwater concerns. I understand the stormwater concerns of the neighborhood, but I strongly agree with the applicant that those stormwater concerns are almost entirely to do with the current situation, and I believe that our standards are strong and that the stormwater would be dealt with adequately by our staff, because they do enforce them, and I deny that they are not strong. I believe that they are strong. In terms of the issue of the orderly transitions, I understand, I believe Professor Halpin, if I have your name right, sir, I understand your point, but I think that this is a trade-off. There are two ways to look at this orderly transition issue, and I understand the point that was made. But frankly, it would be a good and orderly transition to have some medium density, low density residential there. And this is a good corner for development. This is a major highway, and this is exactly the kind of place that we do want development. We have a trade-off all the time. We have trade-offs all the time. There are, and one of the trade-offs in this situation is that we need housing in Durham. We talk about having affordable housing, and we've talked about the affordable units that have been proffered here, but I think even more than that is the fact that if there is demand, and as long as we're not meeting demand, and I have to say that I voted against two developments to meet demand last week, and I'm voting against another one today, but I'm troubled by it. Because as long as we're not building, so law and supply and demand is immutable. We'll be forcing people to live farther and farther away out of town. So again, I'm not troubled by the stormwater treatment. I'm not troubled by the traffic. I'm not troubled by the protest petition. I appreciated the point, but this is something that's been dealt to us. I'm totally in favor of having the protest petition, but we don't. It's the world we're living in now, and it's something that we have to deal with. And I think that this is a good place for this kind of development. What does trouble me, as I say, is the buffer. Is the most significant thing that troubles me, but it's pretty significant. I can see why that is troubling to the neighborhood, and that's my reason for voting against it. But if this comes back, I want to say to the members of the neighborhood, and that issue is dealt with, I will be voting for it. And I believe very strongly that this is a good place for residential development, and I understand the landowner situation. I thought that Don Moffitt made some great points about that earlier. If folks want this to be a park, or if Duke feels strongly enough that this is important to the forest, I use the forest once a week myself. It's an incredible resource. Then somebody else needs to step up and pay for it, not this landowner. So I will be voting for the motion that the mayor discussed, but I would expect that we'll have this back in front of us, and if the buffer issue can be adequately dealt with, that I would be supportive of this at this level of density. Thank you.
I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that I think probably most people are seeing how this is going to go. I'm probably going to be heading out for the game as soon as the plan amendment is over. So I want to make a couple comments on the rezoning aspect of it. I was very troubled by some of the issues and plan to raise them. I had questions for staff, and which I'll pass on. But I want to appreciate all of the staff that's been here tonight, particularly our stormwater people who don't normally have to come to our council meetings. I did have questions and concerns about what I thought was a penalty for affordable housing that made it fairly easy to do a payment in lieu. I had concerns about the size of the buffers between Colony Park and this proposed project. I have concern about the fact that there's a little to no buffer along Cornwallis, and I would like to see a visual barrier along Cornwallis, because I think what we're going to wind up here eventually will be some kind of density. And I had some concerns about the impervious surface. Now, I want to point out that we approved a project earlier this evening that some of people have held up to me as an example of good development, and I don't disagree, I voted for it. But it had 100% impervious surface limitation. It had very little in the way of committed tree preservation. The density was high. One of the differences is they did work with the neighbors very closely. They did have, as you saw, there was no one in here in opposition to that project that I remember from way back. And so I think that I thought that the plan amendment was going to pass. I didn't second the motion, Mr. Mayor, because I figured if five other people wouldn't second it, that it wasn't going to go anywhere anyway. But I did have my reservations. I did not actually think that the rezoning might pass tonight. So it looks like I was wrong, at least on one count. Thank you.
Other, recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess I'm very interested in what Ms. Feinberg said about the, and she may not know about the history in terms of what kind of opposition might have been proposed to the original sale of the land that created Colony Park. But I've been thinking about this proposal being very analogous to lots of opposition to immigration that we have nationally, that often people who are here in this country now oppose others coming. And I would hope that is not the case, although there was at least one comment that was made about the idyllic nature of the current development and how people had the idea, at least that one speaker had the idea, that they did not want to have that beauty disturbed by this other development. I would hope that we would not maintain that attitude in the future when there is a proposal for land use that might be more conducive to what the neighbors might want. Thank you.
I just want to make sure we're clear on what we're voting on. I would ask the council if you would pull up attachment 2 on your if you vote for the motion, it means that the future land use map remains as is. If you vote against it, then in effect, you could get the proposed amendment. So I just want to make sure people are clear on what we're voting. And again, my hesitancy for supporting the developers is I feel really strongly that there should be some type of transition between the two properties. And that doesn't happen with the proposed amendment. So are we clear on this? Madam Clerk, will you open the vote, please? You close the vote.
The motion to deny the plan amendment as recommended by the Plan Commission passes 6-1 with Councilmember Moffitt voting no.
That's correct. That's me being consistent.
Thank you. Okay, let's move to the next item. Zoning map change, Cornwallis Road, property Z1500031. That's item 24.
Good evening. My name is Grace Smith. I'm with the Planning Department. This case is a request to change the zoning designation of 40.95 acres located at 2417 West Cornwallis Road, south side of West Cornwallis Road between Welcome Drive and US 15501, from residential suburban 20 and commercial general to planned development residential 4.131 to allow for 126 single family residential units. The development plan associated with this request commits to the following: 126 single family residential units, two vehicular access points, a maximum of 70% impervious surface, 20% tree preservation, two greenway easements through the site, and a pedestrian access easement from Tanglewood Drive. Based on your action on the previous item, staff determines this request is not consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances. Staff is available if you have any questions.
Okay, this is a public hearing. I've heard the staff report. Let me ask other questions by members of the staff. If not, let me make sure we're straight here. The persons that have signed up in opposition to this item, do you still want to speak? Let me ask other proponents. I just still have Patrick, Lau, and Jared. Is that it?
We're just going to request a continuance similar to the case you had earlier today, Mayor Bell.
All right.
Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of the City Council, my name is Patrick Biker with Morningstar Law Group, representing Pulte Homes. We respectfully request a continuance of this matter, that we hold the public hearing open in order to address the concerns that have been heard tonight, try to come back with the appropriate measures to address the Council's concerns, and bring this back to you at the appropriate time.
As the city manager.
Mr. Mayor, I would request either the city attorney or the planning director comment, but I believe it would be appropriate to specify a time that at least preliminarily we anticipate this would come back, and then if we need to continue it further from that point, we could, but it's difficult if we just leave an item like this open without a specific date identified.
That is correct. Staff would request, in order to continue the item, that you do have to specify a date that you would like to have this item back.
I'm asking the proponent. Do you have
we would request two cycles, Mayor Bell.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I defer to the planning director. I mean,
no.
Yeah. Are you comfortable with that?
The one thing I would suggest for Council's consideration is that a two-cycle delay does not give a lot of time for a lot of review and modifications to occur. We're already into your next cycle Thursday.
That's fine.
Give me a time that you suggest.
I think three cycles or four cycles are appropriate.
That's fine.
All right. Is it three or four?
Let's make it three, and we can always continue it if we need to at that time, but we'd ask for three cycles.
Okay, you've heard the developer's recommendation, you've heard the planning director's recommendation. Entertain a motion on continuing the public hearing until three cycles. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
I'm sorry, I do want to speak to the comment that we can just continue it if we need to. We've got a room full of neighbors. I suspect we will have a room full of neighbors. I do not want to request a room full of neighbors and then say, yeah, let's continue it a couple more weeks. So if we're really, I'm not entirely, unless the applicant figure out a way to work more closely with the neighbors, I don't really see that there's going to be a significant change. Okay, so let's hold it. I'm sure everybody wants to get out of here. Certainly I do. And when we still have more business to transact tonight. So I will be voting against the motion in any case to continue it, but I do recommend, unless we're convinced we can do it in three cycles, I would recommend four. Thank you.
Four is fine. We can live with four.
Let's go with four. Entertain a motion on that item.
June 6th.
June 6th specifically, okay. Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote.
It passes 6-1 with Councilmember Moffitt voting
okay.
No.
Consistent, Don. Okay, great.
Thank you very much.
Let's move to supplemental item 28, public hearing on the proposed economic development incentive agreement between the City of Durham and Arabidan Farmers USA, Inc.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening.
Madam Mayor Pro Tem, City Council, and staff. I'm Kevin Dick with the Office of Economic and Workforce Development, and pleased to have the opportunity to present a proposed economic development incentive agreement between Aurobindo Pharma USA and the City of Durham. It is important to note this evening that what is being presented is a recommended economic development incentive agreement. And the location of this project in Durham is contingent upon a matching amount from Durham County government and a job development investment grant from the State of North Carolina Department of Commerce. In other words, the final decision of the company to locate here and the ability of the state to provide a job development investment grant would be based upon local amounts being approved by the city and county. So this any decision tonight in and of itself does not guarantee that the company will locate. Just in terms of a company profile, this is a pharmaceutical company with U.S. headquarters in New Jersey. This is an Indian pharmaceutical company. They are a market leader in semi-synthetic penicillin and has a presence in therapeutic segments such as neurosciences, cardiovascular, antiretrovirals, anti-diabetics, and gastroenterology. Just for further edification, retroviruses, one of the more common retroviruses is HIV, and other retroviruses can lead to cancer. So this company essentially produces medicines and drugs that combat two obviously very detrimental viruses in our society. Aurobindo Pharma USA is one of the 10 top 10 pharmaceutical companies in terms of generic brands as far as the number of prescriptions they dispense. Aurobindo has plans to create new service lines and will grow the research and development business to develop new inhalation and dermatological products. And the manufacturing facility would then create these products. So the facility that they intend to locate in Durham and retrofit would actually be the former Teleflex facility on Weck Drive. If you've seen that facility, it's in dire need of renovation. So this would be a welcome project. In terms of potential job creation, this project's very attractive for us. There are manufacturing production jobs in the biopharmaceutical industry. These are the types of jobs that we covet in the sense that they're varied in terms of having a production component, but also administrative components and higher management. Of the 200 jobs that are slated to be created within the next 3 years, or the better part of the next 3 years, 113 would be manufacturing production jobs that line up well with some of the training options that we have within the NC Works Career Center system, specifically at Durham Technical Community College. And the average wage for the positions would be in excess of $54,000 per year with full benefits. So these are exactly the types of companies and projects that we have coveted. The proposed offer would be $200,000, not to exceed $200,000 at roughly $1,000 per job. And this would be paid in a lump sum once all of the jobs have been created. So the risk to the city would be minimized from that standpoint. The funding source for the project would be the increased with the tax revenues that the city would receive as a result of the $31.7 million that are anticipated in capital investment. And as I said, no incentives would be paid until the jobs were created. I'll reiterate that Durham County is considering an offer of a similar amount, and as well, and the North Carolina Department of Commerce is also considering a job development investment grant that would be in excess of the city and county combined amount. But again, that this is an ED incentive agreement that is only an agreement only and does not guarantee that the company would locate here. So to recap, the creation of 200 jobs within 3 years would be a precedent that would be a contingency for incentive payments to be collected by the company. There would be completion of $31.7 million in capital investment. There would be the inclusion of a workforce plan that stipulates the use of the NC Works Career Center. And as I said earlier, we do believe that this company, this project is very conducive to the talent that is currently being produced by the system. And there would also be the inclusion of a Durham-based business plan, which would enable Durham-based contractors, including minority and women business-owned enterprises, to have an opportunity to bid on contracts that are related to the redevelopment of the proposed site. The capital investment at the stated levels are expected to result in nearly $400,000 in new tax revenues over the first 5 years, and then an additional $310,000 after another 5 years. So a total of $700,000 would be anticipated to accrue from the redevelopment of the proposed site. And so a $200,000 investment would be well within an amount that would be a responsible amount for the Durham taxpayers based upon the funding source. With the Durham-based business plan, we are anticipating a goal of 25% of Durham-based businesses, and we've discussed this with the company in terms of the construction work to be done. Our goal would be nearly $8 million in contracts that could go to Durham-based firms, including MWBEs, based upon the capital investment. Why is an incentive necessary? $200,000 in city investment is needed to make this project feasible in Durham because, as I said earlier, biopharmaceuticals is a coveted industry, and there's evidence that not providing the incentive here would result in the project occurring elsewhere. The U.S. headquarters for this company are in New Jersey. There's ample land to produce this project in New Jersey, but the offer of the job development investment grant, the obvious talent advantages that are in this region are making the company consider North Carolina. The state is proposing an incentive that requires an adequate local match as per the rules of the Job Development Investment Grant. And why does this project make sense for the Durham taxpayers? 200 high-paying jobs within a growing industry, which has significant multiplier effects for related industries. Recruitment of a great corporate citizen that intends to use the NC Works Career Center system to recruit talent, and also will commit to support the Durham Youth Work Internship Program, either as a site for career exploration, as a host and a sponsor of an internship or multiple internships, or as at least as a sponsor of internships. And so, with that, I'll take questions. I do want to recognize Ms. Katie Culp from KSM Advisors, representing the company. She's present this evening to represent the company and to answer any questions you may have.
Okay, thank you, Kevin. This is a public hearing item. The public hearing is open. I would ask first other questions, comments by members of council. I see the Mayor Pro Tem.
Yes.
And
good evening. What kinds of skill sets will be required for these positions that you've talked to us about?
So generally, short-term certifications in bioworks or biopharma type training that's offered within the community college system. There are also some manufacturing type courses, certified production technicians that are, again, as I said, more short-term certification type courses. So degrees won't necessarily be required, although they may be welcome as well. They won't necessarily be required.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Nice, Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, I just wanted to say that I think that job creation is one of the most important things that we do, that and land use. And we're looking at up to 200 really good jobs that don't require a full four-year college degree, most of which what I understood you to say, for the cost of 4% for one-year salary. I think I have that number right. And somewhere in there, I don't know what it is, 2% of one-year salary. In any case, this is the kind of thing I think we should do. There's no risk to Durham taxpayer, because if they don't invest and don't create jobs, we don't make any payments. And the cost will be paid for from the property taxes that they'll provide if they do invest. So this is the kind of thing I think that we should be supporting like all day long. I appreciate it, and Kevin, I know you're going to be around for a little bit longer, but Charlotte's gain is our loss, and we will miss you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you saying that.
Are there other questions, comments? I want to close the public. Is anyone else in the public that wants to speak on this item? Recognize Ted Connors. Apologize, you had signed up. They just gave me a card. Sorry.
I did follow the rules, although yeah, I feel right. A little pressure standing between you and the basketball game. It's a scary position to be in. Mayor Bell, members of the Durham City Council, good evening. I'm Ted Connor with the Durham Chamber of Commerce, here to advocate for an incentive for Aurobindo Pharma. The company in this project offered Durham an excellent return on investment with regards to new tax base, new jobs being created for what I consider for Durham residents, and also it'll be reusing a building that really, really needs a lot of TLC. It's been vacant for about 2 years, and it will be nice to get this back on the tax rolls again as a full building. One of the things I like to think about successful economic development is working to attract and develop job opportunities for a broad range of Durham residents. And in the past year, with Kevin's great support, we've been successful in attracting a blend of low to high skill jobs, and we're blessed to have worked with Aurobindo and Katie over the last year, really since about June of 2015, to attract potential great manufacturing opportunities, job opportunities for Durham residents, many of whom will not need a college degree. And so we feel very good that we're bringing to Durham a wide range of job opportunities that will benefit all of our citizens. But it's important to note also that the preparation for these jobs, or preparation to apply for the jobs, can be accomplished through students, Durham residents, taking a training program, which Kevin pointed out, called BioWork, which is provided by Durham Technical Community College. BioWork is a course that residents can take to prepare them for a career path in life sciences manufacturing. Durham Tech also offers other courses to allow the students to learn additional skills and allow them to progress in their career paths in the life science manufacturing. At one time, we had Peter Wildrich from Durham Tech was here, but I guess the rezoning disappointed him and he left. But nonetheless, he is in charge of supervising these workforce training programs for Durham Tech. One important thing that I realized tonight when I was thinking about what I would say in between keeping you from the basketball game was pointing out that in addition to help prepare Durham residents for jobs in life sciences manufacturing, Durham Tech has allocated some of the funds that it receives from Durham County from It's the sales and use tax revenue that is granted to the educational enterprises here in Durham. It takes this tax revenue and that it receives to fund a program called Durham Connect, in which the community college provides scholarships to Durham residents who are taking courses at the university. It doesn't have to be academic courses. It can be these certification programs, thus providing a means for our residents to pay for the training, that allow them a career opportunity. And not too many communities will do this. And so it's really important that we know that we're bringing jobs to the community suitable for our residents, we're providing training and education for our residents, and we feel that this will be great for Durham. Thank you.
Thanks, Ted. Is anyone else that wants to comment on this item? Yes, ma'am.
Hello, my name's Katie Culp. I'm president of KSM Location Advisors based in Indianapolis, but actually had North Carolina winning my whole bracket, so I'm a loyal fan. I'm here on behalf of Aurobindo. Unfortunately, an illness prevented my client from being here, but just wanted to convey a heartfelt appreciation to the mayor and to the council for your consideration. To city staff, Kevin has been phenomenal. The Durham Chamber of Commerce has been incredibly helpful. As Ted mentioned, this has been almost a year-long process, a highly competitive project where we were really evaluating multiple options, including this one in North Carolina. So incentives are an important component here, and certainly appreciate your consideration. And thank you for your time, and happy to answer any questions.
Are there questions, comments? Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
How are you going to advertise to the public this opportunity?
It's a great question. I know it has been made very clear to Aurobindo, and they're excited about the opportunity to partner with some of the workforce development agencies that are based here locally. So I know that they intend to do that. I think there are some traditional ways they'll do it, you know, through online advertising and in the newspaper and that type of thing. And there's been some discussion of job fairs as well.
Newspaper is very important.
Yes.
Some people don't even know
the other thing, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, is that as per the Durham Workforce Plan, they will be required to post jobs with NC Works. And so as people register with NC Works, they will have an invitation to apply to the company, apply online, and certainly we're going to make sure that the individuals that complete training in fields that are conducive to the types of positions that companies are hiring are fully aware of the positions available. We also have rapid response events, which means events where we take staff when other companies that may be similar to this are laying off staff. So we're able to replace people in jobs when they're dislocated as well.
I would suggest that it would be a good idea if you could just have some flyers that could be taken throughout the community to citizens as well.
Sure.
Churches, that kind of thing.
Okay, I don't want to prolong this, but can you just clarify the $1,000 per job? Are these for Durham residents? How long are people on the job?
These are for individuals, period. They're not necessarily earmarked for Durham residents. We have had some consultation with the attorney's office and found that we may be in violation of interstate commerce, rules and regulations. So these are for Durham residents. You know, as I suggested to Councilmember Johnson, we'll work to try to devise creative ways that we can connect Durham residents as much as possible, but we cannot earmark the incentives solely for Durham residents.
How long do they have to stay on the job? They get hired one day, get fired the next day, they still get $1,000?
No, the position has to stay on the books for at least a year in order for it to be considered a job created.
Great program. I hope we can move on it. I'm going to close the public hearing, entertain a motion on the item. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote.
My mouse is not working, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, well, let's vote by hands. All in favor of the motion, raise your hand.
Yeah.
Those opposed?
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Now it's working.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank. What? Okay. And we're not going home yet because we have some faithful citizens that have signed up and pulled item 4 on the consent agenda. So I'm going to recognize those persons who have signed up and pulled this item. And this item is, I want to call it out so it's for the record. It's item 4, and it reads FY 2016-2017 Budget Development Guidelines. Is it Dante Strabino? Is that Dante? Say what? I'm just calling the names. Max Davis, Dwight Walker. Is Dwight here? Carlos Stanley. Is Carlos here? Donald Quick. So if you can come to the podium to the right, please. And Nathanette Mayo, I miss you. Okay. And if you could limit your remarks to 3 minutes, please.
Good evening or good night. I am Max Davis with the Durham City Workers, and we have a proposed budget for this year. I won't go down the long list. Should be receiving copies of them. And we are in opposition of the $81 million that's been proposed for the police headquarters. We think that money could be better allocated throughout the city for city workers in order to receive raises, in order for recreation center, living wages for all workers, crisis intervention, and just last, I guess, staying within my 3 minutes, I just want to say that I think we're always talking about good things that are happening in Durham, that Durham works better when all the city employees as a whole work, not just one group of employees.
Thank you.
Hi, Nathanette Mayo, Secretary of Durham City Workers Union, UE 150. We're here today on April 4th to commemorate also Dr. Martin Luther King's death and why he died, why he was assassinated by a domestic terrorist in Memphis, Tennessee in 1968. It was his stand with public workers, with sanitation workers of that city who was standing to fight for benefits and just respect on their job. So we're here today to honor him, but we want to say too that we stand with the communities that we live in and that we work in. We want and will struggle for the passage of a budget that invests in our communities and city workers, and that does not include one that spends $81 million on a new police headquarters, but $81 million on replacing broken down garbage trucks, adequate safety gear, lowering healthcare costs, full staffing of vacant positions, livable wages, $15 for city workers and contracted workers. We call for a $2,000 across the board wage increase for city workers and cost of living increases, worker training and an end to discrimination and favoritism in hiring, promotions, training, and discipline in the water department and other city departments. Improved and free mass transit, extended and free programming at community centers, sidewalks and improved streets, lower utility rates and tax assessments, crisis intervention resources, restorative justice programs, and a reformed independent civilian police review board, and a number of other things that our communities and city workers need. The quality of life in our communities affects our jobs, and the quality of our jobs and our work environment directly affects the quality of life in our communities and our families. We want to let the City Council know and the manager know that the City of Durham workers, UE 150, we will stand with our community allies, we'll stand for, we'll fight for, and we will support a Durham budget for the people. Thank you. We'll be here throughout this whole budget process.
That's good.
Thank you.
It's a public process, and we appreciate all that want to come.
Good evening. My name is Donald Quick, Mr. Mayor, City Manager. Basically, I'm here with my comrades. You know, this $81 million, we could use it for some training because in my department, I was switched to another department, but I never had training. And it was like, you know, I'm going to this department, but I was never taught basically what I needed to know, you know. But I'm in there and I'm learning. I had to learn basically on my own. I didn't want to go in there and disrupt nothing, or if something happened, then, you know, they looking back at me. But $81 million, that's a whole lot of money for a new police headquarters. I mean, we got substations. We also got the police headquarters downtown, you know. I mean, it could be used for something more than just a police headquarters. Maybe we can rethink it, take part of that money and do put in some training and do, you know, help the workers. Because, you know, I'm speaking for the sanitation workers, I'm speaking for water and sewer, I'm speaking for, you know, the public works department, all of us, you know, the fire department, you know, we all work hand in hand. If there's no water to put out a fire, you know, then there's no water. Water and sewer is a great supplier of fixing main holes and whatnot for the water to flow so we can put out fires. So, you know, we just asking that, you know, y'all consider us, you know, because it seems like to me it's always about the police and fire. But we as citizens, you know, we do our duties to the public. That's who we work for, public works. You know, when people look at their trash can and their trash has been emptied, that comes from sanitation. When a main line busts and that main line is fixed, you know, that's water and sewer. When there's problem with the streets or whatnot, you know, potholes, you know, that's public works, that's street maintenance. So we just asking that y'all will consider, you know, looking at this, maybe redoing it or whatnot, but we just want to thank y'all for y'all time and y'all be blessed. Thank you.
Welcome.
Good evening, Council. My name is Dante Strabino. I live at 2400 Yorkdale. I'll keep my comments brief. I think you all have seen the outrage and frustration from the community about the ongoing inability for any accountability for the police with the murder of Levante Biggs. You know, we're in touch with the family. They're still crying for justice. Nothing has been done to hold the police accountable, and we still want to spend all this money. I know this is a big review process, accreditation they just went through. You know, was the issue, but there still is a lot of people that are concerned, and that the spending of this money in East Durham and East Main is upsetting to us. And as city workers, you know, think that that money should be spent, you know, other places. You know, we hope we can continue to, the council will continue to consider and work around the concerns, the deep concerns around the racism in the water department, the recommendations from the Human Relations Commission. We're still and hope to work with Mr. Bonfield and others to implement those recommendations, especially on the grievance procedure, hirings, promotions, all those aspects, and to open up and go back to a procedure we used to have where workers could actually have file for a broader range of issues and the rest of the recommendations that we hope to continue to work with the council on moving forward and as that process is open. So stop there. Thanks so much.
I think that's all the persons that had signed up to speak on this item. Let me say, and I'm not going to prolong this, the concerns that you raised, they're not mutually exclusive in the sense that if you have a police department, you can't have some of these other things. Likewise, if you have some other things you're asking for, you can't have a police department. They aren't mutually exclusive. It doesn't mean that you can get all that you've asked for, but it's certain things we can consider. These things don't happen overnight. I hear this piece about affordable housing. Affordable housing didn't happen overnight in this community. We've made a commitment to do more than we're doing. That's why we had a consultant come on board. That's why we've got a special session Thursday to review the consultant's report. So hopefully we can come up with some guidelines as to how we're going to move forward. But these things didn't happen overnight. But I think it's unfair to pit the police department against all these other issues, because there are other departments we could also say you didn't have to do. We could have spent money otherwise. We have to set priorities, and that's what we go about the business of doing. The police department wasn't done overnight. It's not like we decided overnight that we're going to build a police headquarters on Federal Street, on Main Street. There was an open public discussion on that, and we looked at the various sites, and the net of it is we came down with the site that we have. But by the same token, we hear the questions that you're raising. We're sensitive to the question that you're raising. The question is whether or not we can come to some type of compromise in what you're requesting and what we have to do as a council. But please don't say these things are mutually exclusive, because they aren't. It doesn't mean if we build a police headquarters, we can't do any of these other things. Likewise, it doesn't mean if we do these things that you're asking for, we can't build a police headquarters. We've got to find a compromise. And that's what we're in the process of doing. I welcome you to come to the budget meetings when they open. If we have an opportunity to comment, I welcome your comments. And we will look at what you're presenting here this evening. There's no promise that it's going to happen, but we'll look at it very closely to see what we can do. And it takes time to get to some of the ends that you're trying to get to, but you got to start somewhere. And I for one, am committing to the start. How long it takes us to get there is another issue. Having said that, we have this item on the consent agenda. I entertain a motion on it.
So moved.
Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, can you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Great. Any other items to come before the council tonight before we head out to see the final results of the final four? Somebody's probably got the results. What's the result?
Half time.
Okay, we got time. Thank you all. Good night. Meeting's adjourned.